the biggest, bloodiest horror show in history.
Haunted Heartland.
Men become animals and eat their victims.
Sixth annual Haunted Heartland.
But you will sit there and suffer through the tortures of the damned.
Welcome to our 6th annual Haunted Heartland. We're so glad you could join us for another year of bone-chilling tales.
Now, we have a lot of stories ranging from a gravel road with 7 murders to a blizzard that happened in 1997, and also ranging to the haunted Pike House this year.
I'm your host, Anna, here in the studio with my co-host.
Harrison Popp, that's me.
We've also got Jodine Brownlee in the studio, along with our amazing producer...
Hello, hello.
Ben Phillips. We've also pulled some amazing stories from the archives to celebrate 6 years of Haunted Heartland. So to start off, we're going to go to Simon. If you think living in a fraternity house means nothing but parties, you'd be sadly mistaken. Reporter Simon Ristow brings us to a house on the corner of 39th and Dodge, where the fraternity men of Pi Kappa Alpha have lived for the past 16 years. Although the tenants think they aren't living alone.
The Pike House is 124 years old. That age comes with history, and that history might explain the strange things that fraternity's tenants are experiencing.
If I had to guess, 10 to 15 at least deaths in this house, in these walls.
For me personally, whenever I walk in the basement, it's super heavy.
Mitch Pranty is a Pike alum who lived in the house in 2015. And during his time there, he saw things he'll never forget.
I was like, screw it, bring it on, ghosts, one night. That was a bad move.
One night, Pranty was sitting upright in his bed watching Netflix until he fell asleep. Waking up around 3 a.m., he looked out his door into the hallway and saw...
just this like dark shadowy figure in that closet on the third floor hallway, and like I can't help but like just keep looking over at it and looking down and looking over at it and looking down.
This shadowy figure on the third floor had a presence in the house for some people, but that isn't the only ghost that's been reported.
And then for whatever reason felt a small child's hand touch me.
Gracie is the name that Pikes have given the ghost that they believe is responsible for the sounds of giggling and the presence of a child felt throughout the house.
And he just remembers waking up to hearing just a small kid giggling. This is a fraternity house. I couldn't tell you the last time I've ever heard of small children being here, ever.
People always say they hear, I hear little kids running around, or kids' voices, things like that.
That last guy was Jim Kresnick, Pike alum from the 90s and current owner of the house. Since purchasing the house in 2002, Kresnick has done extensive research about it.
It was built as a single family residence for the McWhorter family. They lived here for the first about 17 years, and then in 1911 they sold it to the Reddicks.
Since it was built in 1894, death has plagued those who've lived in the house, starting with what tragically happened to the McWhorter family.
Their only daughter, she tripped and fell on the second floor, and she died of a brain injury. Like, she probably bleeding on the brain that went undiagnosed. So she, to my knowledge, would have been the first fatality in the house.
Then, once the Reddicks lived in the house, their losses due to the Great Depression proved to be too much for Mr. Reddick's heart.
He died in the second floor master bedroom, and his body actually laid in state in the house where they came, people came to pay visit, pay their respects.
After that, the house had a bunch of different uses. It was a rooming house, a hotel, and a tea room where they would rent out the second and third floor to whoever could pay. At some point during this time, there was a woman with 2 children living at the house.
And they were basically broke. They had nowhere else to go, and the kids would run around the house and play because, you got 10,000 square feet to run around, and, back in 1930, 1935.
According to the legend, these hard times got the best of the mother.
In the basement, she had smothered the kids, because she was going crazy because there was no work, there's no money, no chance, no future.
While this story can't be corroborated with any news releases, Kresnick says, since it was during the Great Depression, that's not surprising.
It would have been so terrible to write about it. They were trying to write about anything good, back in those days.
Eventually, the house became an allergy clinic, where researchers would test new ways to cure people's allergies. Although, some of these experiments were more sinister than others.
One of their methods of treating allergy sufferers was to radiate your sinus passages through excessive x-rays.
This excessive radiation was anything but safe.
And there were for sure patients that passed away that lived in the house. And I know that for a fact because it's recorded on death certificates. And my sister, being a nurse, she actually worked at this property. And she said, oh yeah, that it happened more than you'd realize.
In the late 1980s, the clinic was unsurprisingly shut down and shifted into a convalescent home for people with Alzheimer's for about 9 years. Then, after sitting vacant for a couple years, Pi Kappa Alpha moved in. Kresnik describes himself as a skeptic.
Show the ghost hovering over this table here, like, oh my god, I believe,
But even the skeptic can't explain what happened to him on the very first day he stepped into the house as the owner.
The house is empty. I mean, there is nobody in it. There's nothing in it. I had literally signed the papers on a Monday, and I think it was the next Tuesday or something like that.
Knowing he had some time to kill before he needed to be somewhere, Kresnik took a nap on one of the leftover couches sitting in the living room.
So I laid there, and I remember laying with my hands folded across my chest and having my phone right here so that I wouldn't drop it, you know, kind of half awake, half asleep, but so that the alarm would go off and wake me up so I wouldn't inadvertently, you know, sleep too long.
He slept soundly for about an hour and a half. When his alarm woke him up and he opened his eyes, he noticed there was suddenly a folding chair right next to the couch.
It was no different than if somebody was there and you just pulled up a chair and you sat down next to him, like staring at him. And that chair was right there.
He tried his best to rationalize it.
Did I sleepwalk and bring it? I'm like, I don't sleepwalk, well, not that I know of. I'm like, well, how did I lay back down and have the damn phone on my chest?
But ultimately, he decided there was only one thing he needed to do next.
Or at least at that point, what I convinced myself to be the right decision was get the hell out.
Nowadays, Jim Kresnik thinks that if there are ghosts,
they may be curious about who the different people are from generation to generation, but I think deep down it's good and not evil.
Still, he practices some caution.
Well, I'm not going back till other people are there, and 16 years later, that's always been the case.
And Mitch Pranty may be scarred for life.
I learned that going to bed by 2:30 is okay, or not being in the Pike House around that time.
From MavRadio.fm, I'm Simon Ristow.
Several times over the years, Pikes have gone looking for these ghosts. Some have started ghost hunting crews, while others have attempted to speak with the mother from the basement through a Ouija board. Reporter Simon Ristow is live in the house to attempt the exact same thing. Simon, how's it going over there?
I'm good, Anna. How are you?
Pretty good. All right, Simon, where are you in the house right now?
So we're starting here on the third floor, and the sun's been setting, and as the light has trickled through the windows, it's created a very eerie atmosphere, and even some of the tenants have lit candles throughout various rooms in the house, so pretty spooky where we are, but we're going to continue down the stairs onto the second floor, and the staircase here in the house, it sort of follows a spiral pattern that leads you all the way to the basement, and the second floor, there's tenants hanging out in their rooms, playing video games, and having a normal college Halloween night. And we pass them, and we head down into the first floor. And I have a couple pikes with me here on the first floor.
All right. So have any of them experienced paranormal from within the house themselves?
Yeah, so with me right now, I have Kobe Slaughter. How long have you lived in the house, Kobe?
It's been about 2 months, I'd say.
So what did you experience in those 2 months?
I'd say the main thing was the first night I was here. I just moved up here back from my hometown, and we all went to bed at like 3 a.m., and I had to get up at 6 to go to Lincoln. So I got up at 6 to go shower and everything, and right before I hopped in the shower, I looked in the mirror, and I had two massive scratch marks on my back. I don't know if that was from scratching myself in sleep, but they're pretty red and irritated, so that kind of got me thinking there. And then there'll just be times in the middle of the night where, we have LED light decorations kind of around our room, and those will just randomly flicker, like plugged in or not. And then we don't have a shelf to hold our food or anything like that, so we put it all on top of our fridge. And the stuff we put towards the back, like I have a bag of like granola cereal that sometimes will like fall over in front of the fridge, and I'm not sure how to explain that either. And then lastly, there's my roommate has a TV of his own, and sometimes when we wake up in the morning, it'll be like at 6 a.m., and when Netflix pops up, you hear the big da-da. We hear that probably at least once or twice a week, and he tried to explain to me, no, I just bumped the remote, it's just me. And I look over and the remote's like on the couch, like three chairs away from him. So that's just a few things, but that's about it.
Wow. Thank you, Kobe.
Yep.
So it's pretty clear that things have happened to tenants in previous years and things are still happening to tenants. And with that, we're going to move into the basement here.
Does anything seem different about the basement from the rest of the house so far?
Well, it's a basement, so it's noticeably colder, and the walls are and the floor are all concrete. It's a very old-style basement, lots of low ceilings, low-hanging pipes, and I'm actually going to move into the room where supposedly the mother of the two children smothered her children, and this room in particular is very different from anywhere else in the house. It feels muted in a way. The air feels much still, much stiller. And I think this room's colder than the rest of the basement, on top of the basement being colder already.
All right. Well, are you ready to attempt the connection from the other side with all those variables, or?
I'm going to do my best.
All right.
So the person I was meeting to attempt this Ouija board with, he's running late, so I'm going to do it on my own, and hopefully everything turns out okay.
Remember to follow all the rules.
All right. So according to the rules, you have to circle the Ouija board three times, and then you can begin. Hello, spirits that may reside in the Pike house. My name is Simon, and I would like to talk to you. And I'm actually just now being joined by my friend. So if you want to, Ian, introduce yourself.
I'm Danny.
All right, so just put your fingers on the template. And again, any spirits in the house, there's two of us now. If you want to talk to either one of us, we would love... Okay, it feels like it's starting to tug, but I can't tell. Is there somebody here? Answer yes or no. Okay, it's moving a little bit. Very, very slowly, but it is inching. If you can move a little faster, lady, if it's a lady. Okay, it seems to be moving towards yes, which that's very interesting. Am I speaking to a man or a woman? Okay, it's moving again. And my fingers are very gently placed on the seeing device. We're making our way over to the right side of the board here. Okay, it stopped on the letter W. Am I speaking to a woman? Okay, we've gone over to the word yes. If this is the woman who lived here and is allegedly the one who smothered her children, is that true? Are you that person, and did that happen? Moving, but it's staying on the word yes. I think that's enough for me. I don't know how you feel, Ian. We're gonna say goodbye now. So we're gonna circle it three times. And then move it down to goodbye. Right. Goodbye, thank you for playing along.
Wow, that's cool.
All right, well.
Thank you, Simon, for for being courageous and taking that step out at the Pike House.
Yeah. I feel nervous and shaky, but I've never done anything like this before.
It was truly an experience. Well, thank you. You guys have a safe night on to your next stop.
Thank you. You too.
All right. Up next, we're going to have Ryan Fitzgibbons out at the SAC Museum, but we're going to have a quick 2-minute break for you.
I'm Ryan Fitzgibbons, and up next, a story about a real museum that comes to life at night.
You're listening to MAV Radio's 2018 Haunted Heartland, the best time of year to catch the scariest stories all across Nebraska, here on mavradio.fm.
With over 100 different historical planes and missiles, there is no shortage of history at the SAC Museum located just west of Omaha. However, something may have hitched a ride on those artifacts and now reside within the museum. Reporter Ryan Fitzgibbons takes on a wild ride through the past of the museum that could still be here in the present.
Having been here for so long, I've heard of a lot of accounts, and I've seen a lot of things that I can't explain.
Opening in its new location of Ashland, Nebraska in 1998, the Strategic Air Command, or SAC Museum, has been preserving and displaying historic aircraft, missiles, and other smaller objects for 70 years. One person in charge of these items is Brian York, the museum's curator of the past 20 years. Since working there, he and the entire SAC Museum team have been baffled at the odd things that seem to happen regularly.
Maybe our internet will go down unexpectedly, or our phone lines go out, or we'll have lights in the museum somewhere that go out and our facility staff can't figure out why, and then they'll just kind of come back on.
It's not just Brian and his coworkers who have seen and experienced odd things going on in the museum. Many guests have seen unexplainable things as well.
A lot of the accounts we hear are people will walk by and say they see somebody in an airplane.
One such person is Simon Ristow, a current student at UNO, but more importantly, a former Cub Scout with a harrowing story. While he was just a kid trying to earn a badge, his Cub Scout troop decided to sign up for a sleepover inside the SAC Museum. While there, Simon and a group of his friends saw something they will never forget.
But in one of like the airplanes, I was looking up at it for like the longest time just because I don't really know what caught my eye. I was just like looking at it and looking at it, and eventually I saw what looked like a figure sitting in the cockpit.
Once somebody claims they see someone in an airplane, Brian is the one who gets the call.
So I get that call and I go investigate, and I can't find anybody in an airplane. I don't see anything touched, anything moved. Sometimes I'll get a chance to talk to the visitor who makes the claim, and they say, oh no, I saw somebody up there. Sometimes it's just a random person they thought they saw. Sometimes they thought they saw a pilot in it.
The weirdest thing about all these claims? They have never and will never put mannequins or cardboard cutouts in any of the planes. Much like some guests, Brian has one instance that's truly stuck in his mind. A World War II helmet in a display case that just didn't obey the laws of physics.
Every day, when I would come into work, I would walk the museum just checking everything. And every morning, it was tipped over. And I could never figure out why.
Brian would start ensuring he was last to leave at night and check the helmet before he left. But sure enough, every morning, it was tipped back over. So what could be behind all this mayhem? Brian and the staff call the instances the work of museum gremlins. Others, though, have a more sinister theory.
If you talk with some of our visitors, they think that there are ghosts or spirits of the veterans from World War II, Korean War, all through the Cold War, still lingering around the aircraft.
At the time, I didn't think I saw a ghost, but I might have.
Could there be ghosts and spirits still attached to the planes that visitors come to look at? The oldest plane the SAC Museum has on display is a C-47 that was built in 1943 during the height of World War II. After World War II was over, C-47 aircraft were used in the Berlin Airlift, the Korean War, and the Vietnam War. The plane on display was used from its construction all the way until 1969. During the plane's career, it was used by 12 different units, touching people's lives all along the way. Could someone from the past still be connected to the plane in some way? Researchers are curious.
There's a team of paranormal investigators in the area who, they obviously go to a lot of different places, and they always kind of thought it'd be interesting to investigate our museum.
The paranormal investigators that were interested are Omaha's own Tri-City Research and Investigation of the Paranormal, or TRIP. They would get their chance to investigate in 2013, setting up at night to ensure no human visitors would throw off their equipment. They set to see if something truly unnatural was behind all the mischief, and their answer was surprising.
They reported some abnormalities, possible like an energy surge around somewhere that there shouldn't be an energy surge. They couldn't explain it, they couldn't claim anything, but they said there really should be a lot of investigating.
The founder of TRIP, in an interview with the Ashland Gazette, said that during the night, they encountered voices, dimming lights, shadows, and flickering lights. Despite this evidence, Brian still isn't ready to blame spirits of veterans past.
I really can't say either way what it would be. To me, it's all unexplained. As a historian, I always think if you investigate far enough, you can find out the reason for why something happened. And there's some things that we just have not been able to explain, whether it's small items tipping over in a display case, to benches being moved around or lights going out. I think, you know, if you dig far enough, you might be able to explain it, but right now I can't explain some of these things, so I can't say what it really is. I just know it's unexplained.
For MavRadio.fm, I'm Ryan Fitzgibbons.
Whether you believe a person has been wrecking havoc undiscovered, there really are museum gremlins, or that ghosts and spirits are attached to the planes, everyone can agree that something is odd at the Strategic Air Command Museum. Now, we do have Ryan joining us on the phone. How are you tonight, Ryan?
I'm good. I'm just glad I'm outside the SAC Museum and not inside doing a Ouija board like Simon was.
Now, have you ever seen anything when you've gone to the SAC Museum, Ryan?
So I've been here a couple of times, once as on like sort of like a field trip, and then a couple of other times to volunteer here, and I've never personally seen anything. But while being here, you know, they do have a ton of planes, and I could definitely see how creepy it would be if I was here at night. But the short answer is no, I haven't seen anything, but I'm really glad I haven't.
Do they still do the overnight sleepovers for the children's groups?
That's a good question. They actually don't. The person I talked to, Brian, he said that they stopped those for two main reasons. The first reason was that the kids were kind of destroying the planes, which is understandable because they're kids sleeping in planes. But the other reason was that kids were getting too scared and complaining about, you know, seeing things and just being overall freaked out sleeping at the museum at night.
Now, you mentioned TRIP's investigation. Now, have they been back ever since that original investigation?
Yeah, so since I conducted the interview and did a little research, I couldn't find that they had been back here. But I believe that in every kind of article I saw, and according to Brian York, who I interviewed, they definitely want to come back. So we'll be on the lookout for that, and maybe they'll find conclusive evidence this time around.
Now, thanks for the call in, Ryan. We wish you a safe night and hopefully safe there at SAC Museum. Thank you for calling in.
Hopefully. Thanks, Harrison.
No problem. All right, we're going to go to the next story with my co-host, Anna.
All right, this next story takes us back in time to 1997. Halloween is a time where people of all ages eat candy, dress up, and scare others. However, Halloween has some tricks up its own sleeve, especially here in Nebraska. Reporter Harrison Popp drags us into the late eerie days of 1997, of how Halloween had fought back. Here's the recollections of Nebraskans during Mother Nature and Halloween's sinister alliance in 1997.
When October 31st rolls around, people buy their candy and costumes with no hesitation. No thought is given to the weather. We expect a brisk to the air and leaves rustling on the ground. However, Halloween fought back and won in 1997. Mother Nature and Halloween's menacing partnership in 1997 ruined festive plans spanning the region. A once-in-200-year blizzard blindsided Omaha on the days building up to Halloween. The blizzard came with no warning on October 25th, with Nebraska receiving the brunt of the snowstorm.
It was our worst storm ever, by far.
Mother Nature came at Paula Lukowski from two fronts. She was set to give birth at any hour with her second child, and an epic blizzard was bearing down on Omaha. Paula also serves as the corporate communications supervisor for the Omaha Public Power District.
My first thought when I saw everything dropping, and I thought, well, if I went into labor, I wouldn't be able to get out of the house because our neighborhood was blocked off.
Lukowski was forced to juggle two roles, the first being a mother, the second keeping Omaha residents informed and safe. After prioritizing, Lukowski decided to get to work, knowing at any moment the baby could change those plans.
Well, that October day, there really wasn't a forecast for a storm at all.
Eastern Nebraska saw an unprecedented amount of snow. 14 inches fell to the ground in a 10-hour span, packing the streets and trapping residents in their neighborhoods.
The snow was so heavy. It was a thick, wet snow, and it was just coming down hard and fast.
The heavy snow wasn't the only contributing factor to the damages.
In fact, it was kind of a long fall, and there was still a lot of trees full of leaves, which was kind of unusual.
This allowed the snow to land on the leaves and add extra weight to the trees. The extra weight had dramatic effects.
And all of a sudden, in the middle of the night, I started hearing these thuds. And it was the trees, and it was big limbs were just falling down. It sounded almost like a war zone or something, because the trees were just crashing down.
Branches snapped and trunks uprooted. Trees tackled power lines to the ground. Transformers exploding. Live power lines hidden in the knee-deep snow. Chaos was reality for the next several days.
Believe what I saw outside.
The idea of handing out candy, dressing in your favorite superhero costume, and scaring people became more neglected as new details of the blizzard surfaced. When the sun emerged, there were 5 confirmed deaths, 150,000 residents without power, and $60 million in damages.
Pretty much right here in Omaha where the serious damage occurred.
The result? Halloween's cancellation, in which Omaha mayor at the time, Hal Dobb, does not take responsibility.
We did not cancel Halloween, even though the city was pretty well shut down.
It was a public understanding. The blizzard blasted all hope and terrified Omaha.
It was a horrible disaster.
Children were crushed, but not Joe Slabaugh, who was 9 years old at the time.
The advantages of having just a week-long snow paradise completely outweighed not having Halloween.
Not every child and adult shared Joe's sentiment. Empty candy bags, unlit jack-o'-lanterns, and unworn Batman costumes reflected the hollow emotions.
Just sent people out to just kind of look at the damage, and it was so widespread.
People responded well.
Although the snow had not yet melted, all power was restored to Omaha on November 5th, 11 days after the first snowflake. After OPPD's announcement of restoration, their communications supervisor had an announcement of her own. Paula gave birth to baby John just hours later. For MavRadio.fm, I'm Harrison Popp.
Nebraska's biggest Halloween scare, 1997, was when Mother Nature shook the region. The unannounced wrath of the blizzard instilled fear into Nebraskans like no other nature event. We've got Harrison here in the studio with us. Harrison, did you find out any other interesting facts while you were investigating the history of this blizzard?
I really did. What really started, what piqued my interest to do this story was I was 2 months old at the time, and my parents have talked about it growing up. I've always known about this blizzard, but of course, being a 2 month old, you're not exactly going to remember. And just some background information, I was actually premature, so I was supposed to be born when the blizzard hit. So it's kind of interesting to hear that, but finding out some interesting facts, the most interesting fact that I found out about, which I did address in the story, was when I was interviewing Hal Dobb, he told me that he didn't cancel Halloween. I was under the impression that the mayor and the city of Omaha canceled Halloween. No one canceled Halloween. It was just a public understanding of Omaha and the citizens that this was such a terrible disaster that why would you send out your kids in knee-deep snow? Well, for the kids, it's shoulder-deep snow. So why would you do that? And I found that probably the most interesting fact of researching my story.
Yeah, living here in Nebraska, we definitely see that a lot. Most of my memories of Halloween are either wearing our coat over our Halloween costume and yelling at our mom about that, as well as there actually being snow on the ground or raining or snow while we were heading back from circling the block.
I can only imagine. As an adult, this would be a terrible storm to deal with. But if you're a kid, like the one I interviewed, Joe, who was 9 years old at the time, if you were a kid, you had to have a ball in that storm. You had probably a week of snow days. Oh, that had to be the days, man.
Up next, we've got Seven Sisters Road, as well as some spooky tales from different locations, such as Camp Fear and Scary Acres. But right now, we're going to head off to a break. You're listening to Haunted Heartland on MavRadio.fm.
Make sure to keep your windows and doors locked tonight. You're listening to the 2018 Haunted Heartland.
You just go through with that recording day tonight just as good as you possibly can.
Fear has no name. Fear has no address. Until now. CPEX 104. This is the 6th annual Haunted Heartland.
52 miles south of us exits one of the most gruesome and heartbreaking legends in the Heartland. What drives a man to kill his 7 daughters? Could it be rage? Could it be insanity? Could it be evil? Decide for yourself as Owen Gobberson presents the story behind Nebraska City's Seven Sisters Road.
Society tends to view small towns as friendly, charming destinations where unique experiences await. But as with everything in life, there is always more than meets the eye. South of Nebraska City's apple orchards, you'll find the setting of a rotten urban legend that will disturb you to your core. This is the tale of one man, his 7 daughters, and 100 feet of rope that has haunted generations of Nebraskans. This is the story of Seven Sisters Road. This urban legend has multiple adaptations, but the most common version describes a farmer and his family who lived along a gravel road southeast of Nebraska City. One night, seemingly out of nowhere, the man snapped.
You think you can just do this to me? You think you can do this to us? Oh, you're gonna pay.
What's wrong, Papa?
No, nothing's wrong, sweetie. Go and go get your sisters. We're gonna go for a little walk.
Some say it was due to his wife's alleged affair, some from a blind, drunken rage, and others still say that the man had simply gone insane. Regardless the reason, his daughters were the ones to feel his wrath. The man took them all, one by one, and slaughtered each of his young children, hanging them from the trees on the hills beside the road. Those who dare visit the road at night tell tales with recurring themes. Headlights dimming, speedometers malfunctioning, batteries stalling, distant screams echoing, glowing red eyes staring from the trees where the girl's corpse is dangled. Some locals' eyes light up when asked about the road, each telling their own unique adaptation. Not only famous for its namesake, the road also seems to be home to other restless spirits. Cheryl Ann Fletcher, a Nebraska-based medium, recalls her interactions with the soul of a little boy said to be gruesomely murdered on this infamous stretch of gravel.
I connected with a small child, the youngest boy that was hung, shot and then hung, and then buried. He connected with me. My actual footage, film footage, it shows clearly him grabbing my arm, leaving the impressions in my arm, and also pulling me over to his gravesite.
There are countless ghost stories that emanate from this stretch of road, now known on the map as Road L, just a mile or so south of Highway 75. Some truly chilling accounts have been told by professionals in the paranormal world, but what about those students who let their curiosities get the better of them? University of Nebraska Omaha student Claire Benedicts has her own haunting tale of this cursed stretch of road.
I went there a few times when I was in high school. My friends and I went down out of curiosity because we'd heard about all the legends and we wanted to see if it was all just a myth. And our first times, nothing really happened. Yeah, it was creepy, but what dirt road at 1 a.m. is it? Our last night, though, things got really weird. We got out of our car and right away we heard a really faint scream that sounded like a little girl's. And then I got really freaked out because I thought I saw a pair of glowing red eyes from the tree line, and we got out of there really quick. Thankfully, our car started, and we got out of there no problem, and I haven't been back.
I know many small towns have their own urban legends, and I know what you may be thinking. They're all just silly old wives' tales meant to scare the children or embolden the rebellious adolescent. Ghost stories such as this one are just that, stories. But stand atop one of these hills at night and you'll begin to feel it. The fear building up inside like a slow crescendo, rising and rising, your hands beginning to shake until you hear the distant scream, until you see those glowing red eyes. And then you'll begin to wonder, is it still just a myth? For MavRadio.fm, I'm Owen Godberson.
From the scene of one of the most gruesome stories in the state, we go to our own Owen Godberson, who's attempting to contact one of these restless spirits by the way of the Ouija board.
Hey, what's up, guys? It's Owen Godberson down here at Seven Sisters Road, just a little bit south of Nebraska City. It's known on the map right now as L Road. It took us a little bit to get down here. It's real creepy at night. I've only been once or twice before in the middle of the day, and now that I'm here at night, it's really I have a really uneasy feeling right now. It's a bit spooky, if I'm being honest with you. I usually really like this stuff, but this just has me feeling a little bit on edge, more than I usually am. So naturally, what I'm going to do in this situation is I'm going to do a Ouija board and just see what happens. So, you know, thankfully I have experience in sports broadcasting, so I'll do a play-by-play of what's going on. But I personally don't really think the Ouija boards are real. Like, I don't think that Ouija boards are real. I think they are just usually people messing with each other when they do them in groups, but I'm doing this one solo, so I will know for sure whether or not Ouija boards are real or whether or not, you know, it's just placebo and other people messing with each other. So, you know, here goes, live from Seven Sisters Road here at Haunted Heartland. As you do for every Ouija board, you go around a few times. You have a quarter on the board as well, or a coin of any sort. Not entirely sure what the coin represents, but you know. And all right, is there anyone here with me? Anybody here want to communicate their story or tell me what happened here? Is there anybody listening? If there's anybody listening, I'd like for you to control this pen and answer a few questions about what happened here. Anybody at all listening want to tell me what happened here almost a century ago? All right, guys, I don't really think anything is going to happen here. Nothing has happened as of yet. You know, unfortunately, I was expecting more out of this trip. I really wanted to get something out of it, but doesn't look like anybody wants to talk to me right now if they're here. So it might just be an unwelcome presence here at their resting spot. But, you know, that'll do it here from Seven Sisters Road. Hopefully we'll be back home soon, provided I'm able to find my way back to Omaha. So I'll see you guys very soon. Bye, guys.
And that was Owen Godberson from Seven Sisters Road. We thank him for reporting on that story. Now we're going to go to the next story, which is Camp Fear by Matt Kirkle. But before we do so, we're going to take a quick break. You're listening to Haunted Heartland on MavRadio.fm.
You're listening to Mav Radio's Haunted Heartland on KVNO 90.7 HD2.
You know, being cannibal isn't too hard, especially when you have support of MavRadio.fm's Haunted Heartland. Yorgi, kick it.
I am a cannibal. I eat boys up. You better run.
I am cannibal. Cannibal. I love Keisha.
Hey guys, you're back listening to Mav Radio's 6th annual Haunted Heartland. Now, before we get into Matt Kirkle's story out at Camp Fear, Harrison, I heard a rumor about you, and I just have to get to the bottom of it because it really hits me right in the soft spot. Do you really hate scary movies?
Probably, unfortunately for you, the rumor's true. I don't like scary movies. I've had this discussion plenty of times before. There's just... The plot of scary movies is really predictable.
Like, but that's what makes them so great, Harrison.
For the other day, for instance, I watched Halloween 1 and Halloween 2 for the very first time. And every single scene, I'm like, okay, he's not dead yet. He's obviously going to come back and somehow ruin plans again. What's his name?
Mike Myers.
Mike Myers, that's correct. It's just super predictable. I don't think there's a plot, and it's... Honestly, and in the end, and more importantly, it doesn't scare me. I'm not saying, like, you know, I have some rock hard skin. I'm Mr. Tough Guy here, but it just doesn't scare me. I don't see the attraction of horror movies. My first one I ever watched was Paranormal Activity, and not gonna lie, it was a bit creepy, but like it didn't really scare me. And Owen always brings up how he hates clowns, and Owen Gobberson, he had a story earlier today. He always hates clowns, and he hates the movie It. I loved the movie It, but it's not a horror movie. It was more of a dramatic film. There was only one scene that really scared me, if for people that have seen It. It was when Pennywise is in the water in the basement, and he comes charging the main character, forgot his name, in like a really shaky manner. But otherwise, jump scares and everything else, it doesn't really scare me, and there's no plot. Like, just scary movies, just they haven't latched onto me. Now, I know for you, for instance, you're the exact opposite.
Yeah, anybody who knows me knows that my passion for anything horror, but especially horror films, runs very deep. And I completely agree with you. A lot of the horror films today, especially, they lack that depth and that plot that really gets you. And I mean, James Wan, for example, really focuses on those jump scares because that's really all that we have. And I believe that in today's society, we've become so desensitized to a lot of the things that, you know, our society used to be afraid of back then. And that's why I'm a huge advocate for watching old horror films, because even if it's lacking that little bit of plot, it just has something, the execution of it. And I mean, they're not afraid to go out there and try something completely ridiculous. I mean, Mike Myers walks as slowly as he can, and yet somehow he always gets exactly who he's going for. But I mean, I completely agree with you. Horror movies for a lot of people just don't have that same effect anymore.
No, I also really want to ask you, what's your favorite? It may be hard to pick one out, but what's one of them that comes to your mind?
My absolute favorite, and I mean, I completely disagree with you on the Halloween movies, because John Carpenter is my favorite director of all time, but specifically when it comes to horror films, my favorite movie ever has to be Christine, which is it's based on a Stephen King short story where I think it's like a 1965 Plymouth Fury is possessed. Nobody knows how, but it's possessed, and whoever it chooses, which in this case happens to be a teenage boy who's a bit of an outcast, he finds it, fixes it up, and it kills basically his enemies, but also those who get close to him, because the car is obsessed with him and doesn't want anyone else to get close to him. And it's just one of those stories that creeped me out so much, I was afraid to get into a car for a couple weeks. Because
that's extreme.
And it's totally extreme, but that's where John Carpenter takes things. And that probably has to be my favorite. Now, my least favorite has to be Gremlins. That was the first horror movie I ever saw. And every time I hear the theme song, I, like, cringe and hide underneath something because it freaks me out.
Now, the one movie series that isn't considered a horror film, but I really want it to be, is The Purge. I think The Purge is great. That actually has a plot.
It does. And a lot of those, the reason why it scares you is because it does apply to society today. And, I mean, these are issues that we have now. And a lot of times the way that people take care of problems that we have with each other is through violence. And seeing that human nature acted out is terrifying. Same reason why, like, quarantine and movies that handle real issues like rabies or outbreaks, anything contagious, those things are real fears that people have. And just like when a stranger calls, you never want to be babysitting somebody and somebody decides to, you know, attack the house and break in and threaten your life.
Now, enough about all that business. We've talked about horror movies enough. It's time to listen to Matt Kirkle's Camp Fear.
All right. Josh Miller is the creator of multiple haunted houses in the Omaha area, including Nightmare on Q Street and Blood Rush at Camp Fear. Scaring started as just a hobby when Miller was a child, but after building his own haunted house in his backyard in elementary school out of just wood and tarp sheets, it became his passion. Reporter Matt Kirkle tells the story of Miller and how he turned Scaring into one of Omaha's haunted attractions.
Not many people possess a passion to terrify others, a passion to see the hairs stick up on people as they scream in horror, a passion to find everyone's innermost deep fear and expose it to the point of insanity. Omaha native Josh Miller has been a student of scares since he was a toddler. Everything from watching horror films to scaring relatives with his homemade props to studying haunted houses in Omaha as a repeat customer, he enjoyed the art of haunts at a very young age.
And I've been scaring people since I was a kid, just popping out from the basement door or whatever, but, you know, scaring the sisters and stuff like that. I love the scary, I don't know why I like the dark, scary stuff, but it just seems so fun and cool.
When Miller was in the fifth grade, his hobby grew into something that he wanted to pursue. Miller, alongside of his few closest friends who shared his same passion, started designing a haunted house that would run along the side of Miller's house and go into their backyard.
You know, the first year we barely had anybody go through, I think. We put some signs around the neighborhood, you know, up, and then I'd put flyers at, like, my school. I'd hand them out and tape them up on above the urinals and stuff and get in trouble for it.
Their first year constructing the neighborhood haunted house was a bit of a struggle. Miller and his friends saved up all the money they could through allowances and bought supplies like wood and tarp sheets to begin construction. Miller and his friends did all the work as scare actors. They used makeup from the dollar store and researched on how to make their own costumes and props. Miller had a total of 4 people acting for his haunted house in the first year.
No, we didn't have that much money because we're just like middle schoolers, but we thought about it all year long.
There was no admission fee to go inside, just a donation jar to make the house better for years to come. After only having around 50 people come through his haunted house in year one, he felt a little discouraged.
By the fourth or fifth year, whatever it was, we'd have, like, you know, a couple other people come through, you know, and we're busy all Halloween night.
The group continued to make their house bigger and better each year. They knew they couldn't keep doing the haunted house in Miller's backyard at the rate people were coming through. So Miller reached out to Funplex to see if they could use their property to build his own house.
Yeah, we reached out to a bunch of different businesses, and I was looking for places with a good enough parking, bathrooms, a good location that would have lots of drive-by business. Something well-known would be preferred, and somewhere that had available space and that would be willing to give it up to let us try and do our thing.
Funplex saw his work and agreed to let them create Nightmare on Q Street. Josh Miller was just 17 years old at the time of its opening.
So we literally went and started from the ground up as, like, kids in high school with day jobs and going to high school and then doing the haunted house.
Nightmare on Q Street prided itself on being the only money-back haunt in the entire Midwest. If you completed one of their attractions called Phobia, which is very similar to Fear Factor in that you must complete gut-wrenching tasks, you received all of your money back. Nightmare on Q Street had attractions like Raven's Nightmare, which was their original thriller. It was their main haunted house with jump scares at every turn. They also had attractions like The Last Ride, which was a simulation where you actually lay down in a real coffin and experience the feeling of being buried alive. And Sideshow Freaks, which was a thrill of creepy clowns chasing you while you complete a maze. UNO student Travis Odom attended Nightmare on Q Street several times and found the experience very different from other haunted houses in Omaha.
I think the thing I like most about Nightmare on Q Street is that you could tell that customer satisfaction was a top priority for them. I mean, I've been to plenty of haunted houses around the Omaha area, and there were just things here I didn't see anywhere else.
Miller went from having only 4 actors at his backyard haunted house to having over 40 actors at Nightmare on Q Street. Miller owned and ran this haunted attraction for 5 years before deciding he wanted to branch out and become independent. With this, he made the investment to purchase property and create his latest haunted attraction at Camp Fear. blood rush.
We really didn't know much about anything for business-wise, you know, all that. We had to kind of learn it as we were going. Everything added up to get us where we are now at Blood Rush.
Blood Rush is the longest haunted attraction in Omaha, which stretches over a mile long, and was ranked the number one haunted house in Nebraska by Cosmopolitan magazine. The house is a 40-minute long thrill in the middle of a wooded area in Elkhorn. Odom has been to Blood Rush as well and noticed many improvements from Miller's first attraction to his next.
I think the length of Blood Rush really adds to the experience because you really don't know when it's going to end. I mean, after a while, you kind of lose a sense of reality, and I think that's crucial for the success of a haunted house.
Blood Rush also has many different attractions. One attraction is known as the Dark Ritual Escape Room. In this escape room, you only have minutes to solve a few riddles to escape a demon named Ramona, who closes in on your soul. Another is called Nyctophobia, Fear of the Dark. It is a haunted journey where, in order to find the other side, you must use your senses other than sight. They also offer the Ultimate Party Bus Pass. With this, you have instant access to Blood Rush and Nyctophobia, a ticket to the escape room, along with a party bus with free food and drinks.
Yeah, we build it all year long. Yeah, we worked from November all the way until we opened this year. And I have a job, so I work 40 hours a week. Then I go out there and work another who knows how many hours during the weekend and during the week.
Blood Rush is in its fourth season, and Miller wants Blood Rush to be one of the most well-known haunted attractions in Omaha. He believes with what they have in store, they could become a household name in the world of haunted attractions.
Yeah, we're trying to get to be the biggest and best, most detailed, most crazy, you know, constantly updating our stuff, making it bigger and better. We want to be competing with the top of the top. That's my goal.
I'm Matt Kirkle with MavRadio.fm.
Halloween night is bound to make the experience at Blood Rush even more exciting. And reporter Matt Kirkle is live out at Blood Rush, experiencing it all right now. Matt, how are you guys doing out there?
We're doing fantastic. It's a great atmosphere on Halloween night. How are you guys doing back at the studio?
You know, we're doing really great out here. Are there a lot of people?
Actually, it's a great atmosphere, especially for Halloween night. We actually just had a school bus show up and unloaded a bunch of kids, so...
There's
a lot of people here, especially for Halloween night. You know, I didn't necessarily expect a haunted house to be super busy. I thought maybe a lot of people would be spending time with their families. But, I mean, there's a line of people outside waiting to get into Blood Rush right now. So, I mean, it's a really cool atmosphere, especially for a haunted house on Halloween night.
Have you guys gone through the house?
Oh, we actually did. It's a really, really cool haunted house, mainly because it's different than a lot of other haunted houses in Nebraska. You know, a lot of haunted houses are like a 5-minute, a 10-minute thing through one house, where this haunted house, you know, stretches almost a mile. We were in there for almost a half hour, 35 minutes going through it. And, you know, there's a lot of cool things about it, too. There's a lot of tight spaces. You know, if you're claustrophobic, it can really kind of mess with your mind. And then there's a lot of really open spaces where people kind of jump out at you and, you know, you don't really know what to expect. I think altogether it does a really good job of kind of creating that creepy vibe along with the intensity of a haunted house.
I know I haven't been out there since opening year, but I remember going through Blood Rush and the moment where you're out on the sand near the river is like the creepiest moment because you have obviously nothing's going to come out of the water, but you just have no idea what's going to happen.
And that's just it, is the darkness, you know, being outside in a forest and like you said, in that area, you know, you don't really know what to expect at any time because you're just kind of out in the open. You know, there's kind of really, there is that factor of you don't really know what to expect at any moment.
What kind of differences did you notice between Nightmare on Q Street compared to Blood Rush?
Well, the first thing I noticed was the length. You know, like I said, this haunted house stretches, you know, it goes about a half mile down and then it comes all the way back around to the front. So, you know, the length of it really does kind of, like it said in the story, make you lose a touch of reality. You know, you don't really, you know what's going to happen next. But, you know, Nightmare on Q Street was, especially Raven's Nightmare, was one individual house where as this kind of stretches out and it's very big and, you know, it covers a lot of area. So I think that's the biggest difference. I think the number of actors definitely upgraded too. I think they're a lot scarier. I think they come out a lot more frequently. I think that was definitely a huge improvement. I think overall everything just kind of gradually improved. Everything kind of took a step up. Both technologically, it's a lot more advanced, and it's a lot better. It's set up much better, and you can tell they've learned a lot from their first haunted house, getting their foot kind of in the door.
Has this haunted house changed your fear of haunted houses, even knowing everything that you know from behind the scenes?
Not at all. I am still terrified of haunted houses. I went through and, you know, it was great. Don't get me wrong. When it comes to haunted houses, this was a top-tier haunted house. But, you know, I still don't want to go in haunted houses anytime soon. This was not something that changed my opinion at all. This is something that kind of enforced it, I would say, even more because there were jump scares at every corner. But it's great. It's a great haunted house. People definitely need to get out here.
I know out there they've got camping areas where you can stay overnight. Do you think you'd ever have the courage to do that?
I would definitely have the courage to do that, I would say, because over in that area, it's a lot more safe in terms of there's not a lot of scare actors trying to pop out and scare you. There's actually a lot of families out here. They have a theater area set up where you can go watch Halloween movies right now. There's a bunch of families out here. So there's a lot of family-friendly things to do if you're not interested in the scare portion of it. But it's great being out here at Camp Fear and at Blood Rush.
That's great. Thank you, Matt. Up next, we're going to have a story about the scary actors with Brady. But you guys have a great night. Be safe out there. Maybe do the locked room if you have the courage to do that next.
We'll see if I can gain the courage, but we're going to have a great time out here for sure.
All right. Thank you, Matt.
Yep.
You're listening to MavRadio.fm. Come back for more.
Red rum! Red rum! Red rum! Red rum!
You are listening to Haunted Heartland on MavRadio.fm.
Halloween is the time of year when anyone who celebrates can transform into something or somebody they're not.
You get to assume a character. You get to pretend to be someone else. You get to act in a play even though you haven't had to audition or learn lines.
17-year-old Rebecca Hartner has been making Halloween costumes with her sisters since she was 11 years old.
It's more personalized, individual, so you know that nobody is going to have the exact same costume that you do.
Every year, she and her sister start out early, coming up with designs and patterns weeks ahead of time to make their holiday night special. Besides the joy of having a unique costume of her own, Rebecca says making your own costume allows you to add details that make your costume both fun and functional.
You can add pockets, you can add lining so that you won't be freezing to death on Halloween. So you can do a lot of things that you can't do simply buying a costume.
But even if you don't have the skill or time to make a costume for yourself, there are still other ways to dress up as something special. The Ibsen Costume Gallery is a 38-year-old Omaha business that creates dazzling theatrical costumes for the stage and the spooky season.
It just seems like Halloween was part of it all the way through.
Dwayne Ibsen is the longtime owner and designer of Ibsen Costume Gallery, who enjoys how nothing is ever the same every day when it comes to making costumes.
And that keeps it all fresh and fun and keeps everybody young and on their toes.
The gallery is a place where people can rent or buy a variety of high-quality retail or specially made costumes, such as gangsters, fairy tale creatures, historical figures, and more, for reasonable prices.
And you won't find that at the 30-day shops and some of the other places.
Each October, the gallery rents and sells 400 to 600 costumes. If you want to have your own Halloween costume idea made and need help, Ibsen will work with you during their slower months of July and August to figure out all the designs, fabrics, and costs so your costume can be ready for Halloween.
It takes a couple of meetings before we ever start.
Even if you can't have a costume made, Ibsen houses over 25,000 costumes, ranging from sizes small to triple X. You can rent for 24 hours. The gallery allows you to go into their stock room and choose different costume pieces to create whatever character you are trying to dress up as.
But if you have an idea of even like, I want to be a showgirl or I want to be whatever, it helps to start there. You may not end up in the showgirl, but it's a starting place.
But if you like to make your own costumes, people are still welcome to stop into the Ibsen Costume Gallery to pick up any necessary accessories, such as wigs or tights, to add a nice finishing touch.
It's amazing what the people do on their own, putting stuff together and then just embellishing it with a feather boa or something.
Rebecca advises to start as early as you can on your Halloween costumes, and if you need to make props and all else fails,
duct tape is your best friend.
For MavRadio.fm, I'm Nicole Torin.
There are a variety of ways that you can make your own special Halloween costumes for next year. If you want to visit Ibsen Costume Gallery for help in coming up with a costume, their store is located at 4981 Hamilton Street, where reporter Nicole Torin is live now. How are you doing out there, Nicole?
I'm doing great. How about you?
Doing great. What is the scene like at Ibsen?
Well, they just closed. I was inside earlier before they closed up shop, and they said they were having a very busy day, a lot of people getting last-minute costumes and masks. And so far, it's in the neighborhood, so there's kids going about trick-or-treating. Pretty fun night.
What is the difference in prices between making your own costume and renting or buying a costume?
So when I was talking to Rebecca, she said making your own costume can be between around $60 to $80 since you're doing all the work yourself. And when I talked to Ibsen, if you want to make a costume through them, it starts at $250.
Oh, my goodness.
Or you can rent for starting at $60 to $65. So it's not exactly cheap stuff, but you're getting great quality costumes. So if that's something a person wants to go for, then it's worth the money.
Absolutely. And there are some people just really get into wearing costumes, especially for those big parties. You're wearing a costume of your own. What was the process like and the cost for yours?
So I decided to dress up as a crab for Halloween because it'd be fun and cute. And I started thinking about that about a month and a half ago because I wanted to have movable legs that I used with fishing line. And it costed me about only $30, but I'm like real cheap, simple. I used a hoodie and made my own alterations. So it probably took about a day's worth of work. So it's not as hardcore as some people get, but still fun that I have my own special costume.
What would you say, I mean, as far back as you can remember, what has been your favorite Halloween costume that you've worn?
Probably the one I wore. I went as Wonder Woman, and that took a lot of work and effort, being able to put all the pieces together. It was a lot of my own making.
Are there any last-minute advice or thoughts about making Halloween costumes that you can give?
I say if you have an idea, go for it. Even if you aren't the best costume maker, just putting in that effort and making it your own thing is what's best, and it's what you can do to make a great Halloween.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Nicole. We appreciate you calling in. You guys have a safe night out there.
Cool. Yeah.
Thank you. Bye. All right. Up next, we're going to have the story about Annie Cook with Devin Ruff, but we're going to have a short break. Sorry, that was really choppy.
You're listening to Haunted Heartland on mavradio.fm.
What have you done to him, you maniac?
Satan is his father, not Guy. He came up from hell and begat a son of mortal woman.
Hail Satan!
Hail Satan!
Satan is his father.
We all have seen the horror movie with the tag, based on a true story. But what if the story happened in your own city right outside your front door? Reporter Devin Ruff takes us to his hometown, North Platte, Nebraska, to tell the tale of Annie Cook, a real-life horror story. We'll shortly get the story up for you for Annie Cook.
Of course, it's Halloween, and we're having some spooky difficulties here in the studio.
No kidding.
Definitely not because of the 6-year-old Ouija board that we've got resting in here.
I already feel like it's the story of Annie Cook, and I believe we do have it uploaded now. So we're going to go straight to the tale of Annie Cook, a real-life horror story in North Platte, Nebraska.
Today, if you were to visit North Platte, Nebraska, you'd find a small train town filled with banks and fast food places. But the early 20th century was a different story. Growing up, my late great-grandmother would tell me stories of when she was a child and lived in North Platte during this time period. North Platte at the time was nicknamed Little Chicago. Between 1920 and 1950, the town had entered an era full of crime, corruption, and hard times. During this period, a woman named Anna Mary Cook, also known as Annie Cook, lived and struck fear into the hearts and souls of the townspeople. A lot of this started after a trip to Omaha for back problems, where she met a woman named Jane, who ran an Omaha brothel. Seeing how much money Annie could make off such a thing, she was sent down into the dark abyss of greed and evil. After she had made enough money through setting up her own brothel in North Platte, she bought the local poor farm, a place where down-on-their-luck townsfolk and migrant workers could come to make a small amount of money. But she wanted more and more. Soon enough, the poor farm became a place of horror and fear. North Platte historian Casey Anderson describes one of these horrors.
One of the migrant worker ladies was very pregnant. The lady went into labor. She made some little kids come up and stand there, and she gave birth to twin babies. And she made those kids take those babies and take them back to a shack and take care of them, but the mother had to keep working.
To this day, some migrant workers' bodies are still found on properties formerly owned by Annie's husband, Frank Cook.
And once in a while, I see a newspaper article in the newspaper, body found on the banks of the Platte River, and had clothes on the body like a migrant worker or something. And then in the article, one of the last lines will always be, property was owned by Frank Cook.
The migrant workers on this poor farm were treated with such little respect and dignity that if one were to get sick and be taken into the hospital, the doctors would have separate tools for the workers due to the high concentration of dirt and gunk these humans had to live with. It wasn't just the migrant workers, though, that felt Annie's rage. Her own family took a beating as well. Her own husband, Frank, ended up living in the barn to escape her.
He just, you know, that poor man. But he let it go on. Mm-hmm. He let it go on. He might have been a good husband, good faithful husband. He might have believed in his Bible, but he done nothing to stop it.
And her own sister, Liz, felt the pain as well. Annie kept her at the house along with Liz's daughter, Mary, so she wouldn't lose a free farmhand and also the money that came with her. And the worst part was, since Annie had paid off most of the Lincoln County officials, when Liz's husband came to, in a sense, rescue his wife and child, he couldn't do anything to help. Even after he brought a lawyer directly to Annie's doorstep. Annie also adopted a boy by the name of Joe Martin.
Annie came and picked him up and told him his mother had died of accidental poisoning. Well, we all know that wasn't true. And then she told Joe, from that on, you're going to be known as Joe Cook, and you will be my son.
Worst of all, her daughter Clara. Not only was she forced into prostitution by her own mother, but after one argument, things took a turn for the worst.
And Annie threw what was called a stove lid handle. That's what she threw at Clara, and it hit Clara in the head. And the story goes that Clara went running out in the yard, ran around a tree 3 times, and then collapsed and died.
Today, the small town of North Platte still shares the stories and learns from them, including tours of the cemetery during this time of year that includes actors taking up the roles of many that lived during Annie's time, including the woman herself. But that didn't come without a couple of bumps. Author Nellie Snyder Yost, who wrote the book Evil Obsession, The Anne Cook Story, had been told multiple times to stop writing the book, and some reports even say she was threatened. By the time of publishing the book, Nellie was ill and soon passed.
The belief was that it was a book that killed Nellie.
You can now find Annie in the North Platte Cemetery under a stone that says just one name and one name only. Cook. A name that tells us of many horror-filled stories. True stories. For MavRadio.fm, I'm Devin Ruff.
And we do have Devin Ruff reporting from a cemetery just in Elkhorn. How are you doing tonight, Devin?
I'm doing well. How are you?
I'm doing fantastic. Now, I got some questions for you. The first one being, what do you think made Annie Cook the monster she became?
Well, she grew up in Denver before she had married Frank and moved to North Platte. And when she was growing up, she worked for her parents, who didn't really treat her equally with her brothers. She never got paid as much as them. She always sort of got angry, got mistreated. And who I talked to, Casey Anderson, the North Platte historian, both of us agreed that a lot of what happened might have started there with her childhood and her upbringing, sort of reflecting how a lot of, you know, horrors happen today with different people, different figures of, you know, death and stuff like that in today's culture as well.
Now, Devin, you being from North Platte, Nebraska, were there any stories that you heard from your parents and grandparents when you were growing up?
Oh, plenty. My great-grandmother, Arlene, who lived during any time, she was born in 1920, lived up until about a year ago. And I would remember going to her house after school, and she would tell me stories. One of the most prominent stories that sort of stuck out in my mind was that when she was walking to school, she would have to pass by the Annie Cook farm while Annie was living there. And everyone, there are many people who share the same story. What they would do, they would cross to the other side of the street to avoid going there. And a lot of people lived in fear of ever going broke or poor, because that would mean they'd have to end up going to Annie and getting help, and no one wanted to do that because everyone knew what was going on. But because Annie had paid off so many town officials, even the cops, nothing, no one could do anything. She ended up dying without being prosecuted for any for crimes. So,
now, other than murder, what were some other unlawful acts or suspicious activity that Annie did during her lifetime?
One of the things that stands out, she had bought over an unknown number of houses throughout the North Platte area and used those to sort of run her prostitution ring that she had going. There are people today who will come to the courthouse and say, I found a house that she owned. And, you know, she was smart. She was clever because she never put them under her name. She would put them under the person who ran that area's name. So even today, the reports, none of them have been confirmed yet because there is no way to trace it back to her. And that could also be because during that time, the courthouse in North Platte burned down that had all those records. And a lot of people connect her back to the crime because a lot of the people who were prosecuted for the crime of burning down the courthouse had several connections to Annie Cook, and, you know, many of the politicians who worked at the courthouse were being paid off by Annie Cook herself and were actually, you know, constant visitors at the different prostitution areas around North Platte.
Now, thank you, Devin, for reporting live from a cemetery in Elkhorn. We really hope you have a safe travel and also a fun night. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Now we're going to move on to another story next from the archives from past Haunted Heartlands. But before we do so, we're going to take a break. You're listening to Haunted Heartland on mavradio.fm.
Look it. It's freaking bats. I love Halloween.
Haunted Heartland on mavradio.fm.
Hey, you made it to the party. It's Sign of Power with mavradio.fm.
You're listening to Haunted Heartland 2018 on mavradio.fm. In an historic building in Omaha's Little Italy neighborhood that's nearly 100 years old, this building is home to both apartment tenants and dwellers of the paranormal. And when they come to visit, they make their presence known. Reporter Ben Phillips walks us through the spirits living in the White House apartments.
Take a drive along 10th Street, south of the Old Market, and you'll see this red house on a hill with its historic characteristics. You might think nothing of it, but this nearly 100-year-old building has seen some unwanted visitors.
And here was this sort of white figure coming down the staircase.
And we both just stood there another second or two, and then he went into the wall.
Two figures, whose souls have been here long ago, returned to the now White House apartments. Owner Gina Basile recalls her encounter with one of the spirits while getting ready for bed.
I walked across the hall to come to the office, and I looked, and here was this sort of white figure coming down the staircase.
This figure is known as the Lady in White, and she's known to haunt the first floor of the apartments, especially one room in particular.
And then she walked straight toward what we would call now apartment number one, and then disappeared through the door.
The White House apartments, although no longer white, wasn't always an apartment complex. The apartments were once a home for Bishop Worthington, the headmaster for Brownell Talbot School, among other uses.
It's been a surgical hospital, it's been a retirement home for nurses, and it's been a retirement Presbyterian retirement home. The Sons of Italy sold it to one of their members, Mr. Lapuza, and he was the one who transformed it into apartments in the 50s.
In the time the building was a hospital, what is now apartment number one was an office for the doctors and nurses working there. So it is said that the Lady in White was a nurse while the building was a hospital. The apartments are known to have weird phenomenons when spirits come to visit, especially in apartment number one. But that might not explain for what happens in there.
We've had people who live in apartment number one say they came home, they were sure that they did not leave any candles lit, and they come home and candles in the bathroom or on the coffee table are lit.
When the building became a hospital, that's when the owner believed the spirits started coming around. But that's not the only spirit who calls the apartments home. Former tenant Mary Noctegal tells of the man in the black hat, the spirit who dwells on the second floor.
I'd start hearing these footsteps coming down the steps in the evening. At that time, there wasn't anyone living on the third floor. I could hear the door open and then nothing. So I didn't think much of it because I felt there was something up here anyway, and it didn't bother me.
For four nights in a row, she kept hearing footsteps coming down from the third floor. It was time for Mary to see what was going on.
So I heard him come down the steps, and the door opened, but this time I heard footsteps going past my door. So I got up, I opened the door, and I stepped out, and I looked to the right. I didn't see anything, but I looked to the left, and the fire escape door has a big window in it. I could see the shape standing in the doorway.
But then she saw someone else.
I could see the shoulders and the head turn in my direction like he was looking at me. I didn't see a face, but I still saw the outline. But it definitely turned and looked at me. And we both just stood there another second or two, and then he went into the wall.
These aren't the first sightings of these spirits. Other tenants have reported seeing both our visitors on other occasions. Mary recalls a conversation with another tenant about seeing a shadow while watching fireworks.
She saw a reflection in the door of someone behind her, and she turned around, and it was a man, just a shadow, but it was dark, it was black, and it was kind of tall. And he stood there and looked at her, and she looked at him, and then he just disappeared.
No one knows the origins of the man in the black hat, or why he comes back to the house. But the next time you travel on 10th Street in Omaha's Little Italy, don't forget about that red building on the top of the hill. And ask yourself, are the spirits making a visit tonight? For MavRadio.fm, I'm Ben Phillips.
With the White House apartment's history, it's not a place you want to be at night, as you never know who or what will be lurking around. One man's brave enough to be there last year. Ben Phillips was live at the White House apartments, but luckily we have him here in the studio with us tonight. Ben, how are you doing?
I'm doing great, Anna. How are you?
Doing really great. We really appreciate you producing for us tonight. You're doing an amazing job. But we do have some questions for you regarding your story from last year.
I'm ready.
Why was the residence turned into, at one time, a hospital?
So back in the early 20th century, like, the basic concept of hospitals weren't around. You didn't have these giant, big hospital facilities. These were all privately funded by religious groups and whatnot. The White House apartments was actually funded by a Presbyterian hospital for the longest time, run by the same person who runs Brownell Talbot School. So it was more of a homey feel. It was more of a kind of like in-home care. So that's why you kind of get that apartment house kind of feel rather than just a big giant facility.
Have there been any paranormal groups or TV shows that have stayed or toured the building?
So believe it or not, the show Ghost Hunters wanted to stay there for the night, but it was so popular that they got turned away, and they would have to like notify all the tenants because it's still an active apartment complex. So you don't want a bunch of people with a bunch of equipment or, you know, ghost monitors like going up and out in front of people trying to get sightings.
I remember being there last year with you, and you snuck into the apartments with a family who was coming home from getting groceries. Now, these apartments are locked for safety reasons, obviously. When you interviewed some of the tenants, did they have any paranormal experiences?
Not the ones that I talked to. So when I went in there for my live interview last year, I did run into one family, not the same one that you saw, but a different family. And, you know, when I talked to the owner and, you know, Mary, like they heard sightings, they saw ghosts, they saw, you know, the lady in white and the man in the black hat. But the tenants there don't really feel anything other than the occasional Wi-Fi being out.
Did the people that you interviewed believe in ghosts before the experiences that they had, or the tenants that had not experienced anything?
So Gina, the owner, she was a big skeptic on ghosts and like, yeah, they don't exist, because she maintains the building. She runs wire and she fixes every little thing. She was a very big skeptic. She was the one who saw the lady in white, actually. And when I was in the apartments, I kind of got a chill. Kind of like a really weird chill in a very cold room. So there was some sort of presence, but she wasn't really a believer. Now Mary was always a believer. So when she saw the man with no head, like she knew there was something going on in that house, because she kind of got vibes and feelings for the longest time.
Now that place is it's beautiful in its own historic way, but definitely has some creepy vintage vibes. You were in there for a long time. I remember we were waiting for you, and we were a little bit scared, almost worried that you were either kidnapped by a ghost or that family we saw walking in with you. While you were leaving, did you feel anything that made you believe that it could be haunted?
Well, I mean, the building was built in the late 19th century, so you had the older architecture. You had a really creepy, there was a really creepy chandelier hanging from it. It was very dimly lit. It just kind of got a very cold, kind of cold room, kind of cold vibe. And I definitely felt some sort of chill or some sort of presence there. And I don't know if it was the lady in white or if it was just my own imagination, but there was something present in that room. I just couldn't put my finger on what exactly it could be. And that's what really creeped me out. That's why I was in there for the longest time, trying to figure it out.
Well, we're glad that you made it out, and we're glad that you're here with us in the studio this year.
I survived.
Thank you so much. Up next, guys, we're going to have another story from the archives dating back to 2013, from the very first year of Haunted Heartland. Stay tuned. We're going to have a quick break. You're listening to Haunted Heartland on mavradio.fm.
Look it. I love Halloween.
Haunted Heartland on mavradio.fm.
You're listening to KVNO 90.7 HD2 Omaha. Power with Mav Radio.
Power with mavradio.fm.
You're listening to Haunted Heartland 2018 on MavRadio.fm.
Here at Mav Radio, we love to celebrate past accomplishments. We're excited to share a story we pulled from the archives, dating back to 2013, during the very first year of Haunted Heartland.
Spirit, this is a safe place. We only wish to communicate with you, ask you questions, and learn from you.
How old are you?
No way.
Holy cow.
With Halloween being tomorrow, people are progressively becoming curious about ghosts, goblins, and dabbling in the black arts. One way to do such is by messing with a Ouija board. Chris Reister grew up in a very religious background and believes that harmless curiosity can lead to a life of eternal damnation.
People who believe in mediums have been turned to the dark side by Satan himself and are giving up an afterlife with the heaven above with Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. A Ouija board turns the users into a medium to the devil while leaving behind the teachings of our God. Leviticus 20:27 states, a man or a woman who is a medium or a necromancer shall surely be put to death. They shall be stoned with stones, their blood shall be upon them. I know many people are weak and unable to see the word of God, but must reach out to these people before it is too late to save them, and they have begun experimenting with Satan's toys.
The Ouija board was first invented by Elijah Bond in 1890 with its intent to communicate with spirits. The Ouija board, or talking board, is a flat board marked with the letters of the alphabet, the numbers 0 through 9, the words yes, no, and goodbye, along with various symbols and graphics. It is now made by Parker Brothers. In 1999, the Ouija board sales started going down when it switched to a smaller, glow-in-the-dark version of the board. In a far remove from the days when the Ouija board led Parker Brothers' lineup in production, the product now seems more like a corporate stepchild. From 1960 to now, the Ouija board sales have gone down over 60%. This board receives more customer reviews that are written in tones of outrage, fear, and ridicule than any other toy for sale manufactured in the United States. Most religious criticism of the Ouija board has come from Christians. In 2001, Ouija boards were burned in Alamogordo, New Mexico, by fundamentalist groups as symbols of witchcraft. Religious criticism also expressed beliefs that the board reveals information which should only be in God's hands, and thus it is a tool of Satan. Assistant pastor Mike McLaughlin knows it's more than just a childish game and looks to God's word for answers concerning a Ouija board.
At face value, it appears to be just a mere game, a slab of wood with some numbers and letters on it, but it's far more complicated than that. It's more than just a harmless childish activity. And so the very essence of the game, to my understanding, is to make contact with the dead for the purpose to receive guidance and obtain answers. And according to the Christian perspective, we look to God's word in the Bible, and it says this: when they say to you, consult the mediums and the spiritualists who whisper and mutter, should not a people consult their God, he says, should they consult the dead on behalf of the living, Isaiah 8. Sorcery, or communication with the invisible powers, is kind of a work of the flesh and should be condemned at some point, and will be condemned.
There are very conflicting rules and reviews on this childish game. For instance, I'm a Christian, using a Ouija board to simply satisfy my curiosity. Am I breaking a religious rule? Am I opening myself up to the possibility of talking to demons and going against God's word?
A Christian is not really to participate in any type of sorcery or divination, and not just because the word of God indicates us not to, but the possible ramifications of playing such game. It opens oneself to a world of spirits which oppose the one spirit we are to communicate with, and that is the Holy Spirit.
Is this board a portal to something demonic? Well, that's what we're here to find out. For Mav Radio, I'm Melissa Ring.
Live in studio, we have a special treat. Two Mav Radio alums from the very first Haunted Heartland, and we're both involved in that story. Missy Ring and Megan Reeder.
Treats. We're treats, Harrison.
Yep.
Now, we've got some questions for you guys. Were you skeptical about skeptical before playing with the Ouija board?
Yeah, obviously, because first of all, it is a Parker Brothers brand Ouija board that Missy and I found on Craigslist. and it's glow in the dark and it has a plastic planchette. I mean, it's just one of those things where you're like,
7 year old.
It is. It's like, oh, we're going to pretend to actually be a Ouija board. I mean, we were totally, totally skeptical.
I'm pretty sure I Googled the rules. Like, what are we actually supposed to do?
Yeah, that's absolutely what we did.
Work? Yeah. Am I truly not going to summon demons? How do I make that work?
We had some of the students leaving the studio today and they're like, just so we know before we leave, how do we do this without getting possessed? And I'm like, all right, well, these are what you need to do.
Yeah, we had to Google the rules. I remember seeing the prayers that we had to say before and after. We had to put a silver coin on the board. All kinds of different things that we had no idea. We were thought like, oh, we're just going to play this game. It's going to be so fun. But it was weird.
I think we took the Ouija board in a couple different areas
of
the college.
We did, we totally did.
Like a spirit or two.
Yeah.
In one of the buildings right over here.
Yeah,
or
we
one
did.
Of the rooms.
Yeah, we did.
Mm-hmm. We tried to replicate it in the lecture hall right across the hallway about a month ago.
Yeah.
With no such luck. But the room does have a lot of technology going on, so there could have been interference, but...
But that night was weird, because I was here for that. Is that night you're talking about?
Yeah.
And where we kept hearing things afterward, that was, Power the Ouija.
Yep. Power the Ouija.
Did you guys encounter anything while you were using the Ouija board?
Definitely. Missy, go ahead and talk about that, because that was weird.
At Hummel Park, we experienced a lot of movement in the planchette. Yeah. And I think at one point when we were asking, I can't remember some of the questions that we asked, but at one point the Ouija board, we asked if they were dead, they died.
Yeah, we asked if it was a man or a woman. How old they were.
Yep. And then at one point, we asked if we should be here. Like, should we be here? And they said no.
Yeah. And remember the weirdest part is when we actually took our hands off the plancha and it was moving. Yeah, and there was no wind.
It started to turn.
Started
to turn.
And it was flush with the trunk. Like, there was no reason it should have. We had it on the trunk of the car that we were in.
Yep.
And there was no reason for it to be moving. It was a perfectly still night. It was, that was probably one of the weirder things. We're just like, are you seeing this? It was pitch blackout, but we're like, we can see this happening, right? Yeah.
That's completely terrifying. And I love how even after that night, it just kind of made a home in the studio.
I know.
And it has sat here for 6 years. I remember my very first year at Mav Radio, I was just doing my show, minding my own business, lean back in my chair, and I see it sitting on top of our tower, and I'm like, what is that and why is that here?
Every single year since we've graduated and the new class of Mav Radio students have come in here, it's always been like, oh, they've discovered the Ouija board.
And I'm pretty sure our success is, due to whatever you guys did. I mean, you don't have to tell us what you did out there. But,
well, I mean,
thank you for the help that you gave us.
The Ouija board is really just to inspire and frighten.
Truly, truly. Well put, Missy. Well put.
Has what happened made you guys more of a believer, or did you ever think that it would have, or has it had lasting consequences for either of you?
It's kind of weird because the only times I've ever actually had a good experience, and for good for lack of a better word, but I guess an experience with it was with our class when we were messing with it a couple days leading up to Haunted Heartland of 2013.
hashtag throwback.
It was, that was one of those things where I'm like, I'm still not fully sure if what we saw was, if it was actually being tricked by it, or if our own minds were, making us believe that that was actually happening, or if it was actually happening. Because when I've played with it ever since, when I've come up to UNO, it hasn't really worked for me the same way.
I think even like when I walked in, I saw it and I opened up the top of the box and I went to take the board out and I just looked at it and I was like, nope.
Yeah, no, I mean, Missy, nope. Definitely, like, I remember how freaked out you were that night. I mean, we had all that weird stuff happened
my
to us.
My phone battery went from 96% to 22%.
Because we all had car chargers when we were out that night. When we were at Hummel Park, we all were at just about 100, if not at 100. And within 5 minutes, all of our phones were dead. Jodine was freaking out. My God, my students have died and I did this to them. We didn't sign waivers.
Looks worse on the news.
Could you guys tell us a little bit, since we're doing a throwback this year, could you tell us about any other stories or experiences you had during the first Haunted Heartland?
Man, so Hummel Park was nuts. Hummel Park was one of the craziest things. I did my story actually on the Black Angel, which I know several students have done recently as well. Yeah. And that was the creepiest thing. So we had gone out to the Fairview Cemetery out in Council Bluffs. And the thing about the Black Angel, because it has such legend behind it, so it is a frequented place, especially around this time of year. And so the Council Bluffs police have an automatic camera that flashes, it's motion sensed, on top of a light pole, and so it's right next to the statue. But what was crazy that night, it was not raining. Mm-hmm. It was cold. I mean, it was October, but it wasn't raining. There wasn't any dew or any kind of mist in the air. And so that statue is said to, by legend, cry, because it is sad for whatever reason. And so when I remember seeing, okay, I gotta go look at its face immediately. And the whole statue was dry except for its face. And I'm like, and so I'm thinking, is there a water spigot, on this thing? And it wasn't. It was wet. It was weird. And it was in the places that you would cry tears. And then that camera started going off on us. And we're like, we got to get out of here.
I think that after that camera went off, though, we saw something near the graveyard.
Next to a headstone. And that's right. A tombstone. And we said, because Missy goes, do you see that? And I go, that man. And I finished her sentence, and she goes, yeah. And I look, and I'm like,
walking amongst the headstones.
Yeah, it was weird. And like, so we called out. We're like, hey, you know, just over here, you know, we're not doing anything, not causing any problems. Nothing.
Nothing.
We're like, oh, okay.
And
yeah.
We drove around to see
it. It was, and there was nothing there after
oh
we drove.
Gosh.
Yeah, that was that. Yeah, that was one of the weirdest moments, basically.
I know we had some other students out last Haunted Heartland out at Hummel Park, and they also had some crazy experiences that they couldn't really explain. And several of them were reporting their stories in their live interviews from Hummel Park.
Yeah, that's
so it wasn't like they were able to get out of there anytime soon,
right?
Because they got to do their job before they can
right.
go home.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, well, yeah. I just remember we had one of our other friends with us, Brandon Mosley, we call him BMOS, and he was with us. And I remember Alex Kuklinski was another former MAV Radio student. He was in the driver's seat. It was his car. And he was basically like, when we were like, hey, it's time to go. So you better put the pedal to the metal so we can bounce. And so BMOS was standing out there with Missy and I. And then all of a sudden he got real quiet and got real focused on like one part of the tree line. And we're going, hey, what's going on? And he's like, and just no emotion, but just very matter of fact. All right, we got to go.
Yep.
And we were like, okay, we're out. Yeah, yeah. When BMO says it's time to go, it's time to go.
And the great thing is we were able to get in the car right away. There was no prank pulled on us
oh,
whatsoever.
That was the worst. They were going to be dead.
Yep.
The boys pulled a prank on us that
locked
night.
The door so we
locked
the door,
started
the
driving away. We were screaming, like almost crying. Why would you do this to us?
I've been out there during the day, and I could not do it out at night.
Yeah, it was probably one of the dumber things we've ever done when we still thought we were invincible.
Right? Just make sure you put that quarter on top of the board, kids.
Yeah, and just put some of that silver on there.
And to say goodbye.
Yeah, that too. Yeah, don't forget to say goodbye because they'll
right.
follow you. Missy knows.
Yes.
Because you felt, remember, Missy, you said you felt really weird the next couple of days, and we had class together, remember? And you
were
like,
a few things that were like flashing on my TV and a few things that I saw flashing on my microwave. It was always like 2-2-2. And it was always flashing,
yes,
and then the
I
next
remember.
Day was like 3-3-3, and I was
yeah.
like, okay, all
right. And I just remember, like, it was like the next day in class, and you still were just very, you felt very uneasy, and I was like, oh
yeah.
God, Missy's
when
been affected.
When I saw that board spin, I was mm-hmm. like, nope.
Yeah.
Nope.
Yeah.
Have either of you noticed anything, just speaking on a Haunted Heartland basis, mm-hmm. throughout the years that you've sat in on and you've watched everything go down, what has changed about Haunted Heartland, and what do you think has made it better?
Gosh, I mean, I've been here every single year since. I've managed to finagle my way up in here, into the MAV Radio studio every year. I think the evolution of MAV Radio, and just with how great that you guys have brought it since we've graduated, and moved on with our lives. But like, you guys are so passionate about this, and this is really cool that we thought we were going to be the only ones who were going to be like, oh man, Haunted yeah. Heartland. You guys have gotten so creative. You've gotten so in depth, and just your stories are always just on point. And you can tell, I hate to say you kids, like I'm an old lady, but like you kids get really, you know,
yeah.
you get really into it just like we did. And that's just really cool to see.
I think there was like a lot of authenticity too in some
mm-hmm.
of these stories, like especially when you do like some of the promos were super cool.
Yeah.
Like I like hear some of those promos and I was like, I don't even know if I can go back
yeah.
and recreate this.
Well,
stuff.
That's the thing. Absolutely.
Yeah.
It's like we did this and we thought it was so good. And then
yeah.
it's like you guys hear it and you hear the past ones, and every single year you build on it and build on it and build on it. And it has just become something that I didn't even think it was going to be happening, you know,
yeah.
5-6 years from now.
Color
so.
Me impressed.
And
me
Missy's impressed.
Impressed.
That's
yeah.
saying something.
All right. Well, it's been a privilege having you guys back in the studio. We love
you.
Having you. Up next, we're going to go to a story about infrared standing after a short break. But you're listening to the 6th annual MAV Radio Haunted Heartland.
You're listening to MAV Radio's Haunted Heartland on KVNO 90.7 HD2.
Make sure to keep your windows and doors locked tonight. You're listening to the 2018 Haunted Heartland.
About 45% of Americans believe in ghosts, according to a 2012 Huffington Post survey. However, that leaves 55% who don't believe skeptics urge careful, critical thinking. While many still wonder if ghosts and the supernatural are real, where do you lie on the scale between belief and skepticism? Is the paranormal evidence that there's really something bigger out there, or just evidence of human bias to see what we want to see? Reporter Katherine Hartner interviews a skeptic and a paranormal investigator for this year's Haunted Heartland.
At college, students learn a wide variety of life skills, such as how to get a job, how to write, how to speak, and how to think critically.
I got tired of hearing just crazy ideas and things that people were saying that were just not scientific and clearly not supported by, like, reality and measurements.
Dr. James Wilson teaches a class called Science and Critical Thinking at UNO.
Can these things be real? Do they violate laws that we know work? What does that mean? If a ghost has to violate, you know, conservation laws of mass and energy, does that mean that that ghost is real or not real?
Wilson says that scientists do not dismiss the paranormal out of hand. Instead, multiple aspects of the paranormal have been studied. The scientific method is a system of experimentation and observation, making science an ongoing journey of constant discovery.
Scientists are interested in weird things because if it's not doing what we think it should, it means that we're wrong about something, or it means that thing is wrong.
While Wilson would love to find out the paranormal was real, he says that we have to be cautious. In the studies Wilson mentions, he says that experiences with the paranormal seem to be correlated with a greater tendency to believe in the paranormal. Skeptics tend to have fewer of these experiences. There is also a danger of contaminating the study by telling people what is being tested, leading to bias. Loopy Buckingham is a paranormal investigator with Rural Investigators of the Paranormal, or RIP.
Once we figure out where we're going to go, then we try to do some research on that location to see what kind of background it has.
Buckingham takes steps to ensure that there is no natural explanation for what she finds.
It's better for us, just the group, to be there as opposed to family members or other business people, you know, that are curious or want to know what's going on. So we ask it, you know, ask people if we can limit it to only us, if at all possible.
When on location, members of RIP do preliminary walkthroughs to determine baseline readings of the area in order to ensure that electromagnetic readings are calibrated. Other factors that can influence an investigation are open windows and the weather.
We investigate things like, what could it be? Weather sometimes can cause a lot of interruptions, but at the same time, if it's thunder and lightning, you might actually get more things happen during your investigations.
What other natural causes might there be for seemingly supernatural phenomena? Many people have looked at infrasound as one possible explanation.
One paper that did one study on one room, I think it was a cavern in England or something like that, and they found a 19 megahertz infrasound there, and they published it, and then everybody grabbed onto that.
Infrasound was first suggested as a possible natural explanation for what were previously thought to be hauntings in 1998 in a paper titled Ghost in the Machine by Vic Tandy and Tony R. Lawrence. It was published in the Journal of the Society for Psychical Research and described an incident of a supposedly haunted lab. Tandy and his coworkers reported seeing dark blurs and the sense that someone was standing next to them when their coworkers were on the other side of the lab. One day, Tandy was working on a fencing foil held in a vise. He left to get his tools and returned to find the foil vibrating. The cause? A low-frequency standing wave in the lab.
19 megahertz is kind of the haunting range.
A standing wave is a sound wave that is constant as opposed to a traveling wave. Infrasound is defined as low-frequency sound between 0 and 20 hertz, generally thought to be too low-pitched for humans to hear. However, Wilson says that's not completely true.
All the textbooks say, like, humans can't hear that, but that's not exactly true. There's several studies that show that some people can hear it, some people can pick it up. And then if you can't pick it up, if it's loud enough, even if it's at that low frequency, you can feel it.
Tandy and Lawrence reported that the source of the infrasound standing wave in the lab was an extractor fan, and once it was turned off, the problem went away. But infrasound might not be the cause of that haunting feeling after all.
There's a few studies that show weird effects, like nausea or feeling anxious or scared or, you know, disheartened and that kind of haunty feeling. The problem is that all these papers that show some effects on people, there's no clear mechanism for it, and the symptoms are not the same, and they're not really replicable.
Wilson says that the scientific community does not accept the supernatural since it's not replicable in a lab setting.
So if you can't test it, it's definitely outside of science.
Like Obi-Wan Kenobi finding Kamino by the effect of its gravitational pull, or discovering the existence of dark matter by its effects on the expansion of the universe, Wilson says we should be able to observe the supernatural by observing its effects.
If you had a poltergeist or something, and it never showed itself and you could never measure it directly, if it throws books around and stuff like that, you can measure that, and you can draw conclusions, you know, inferences based on that evidence.
For aspiring ghost hunters, Wilson has two pieces of advice. Be aware of your own bias, and understand that your instruments may not test what you want them to, especially since digital recorders and electromagnetic field sensors are unproven to test for the presence of ghosts.
It'd be cool if they were there. They could answer some questions.
It's true to them, and we don't want to tell them that it's not happening. We just tell them that while we were there and we did our investigation, nothing happened.
From MavRadio.fm, I'm Katherine Hartner.
On a night like Halloween, it can be hard to be a skeptic. The paranormal is, for many, a matter of a fierce debate and a personal belief. However, all it takes is a quick Google search or even a trip to the UNO library to find multiple articles on this topic. Now, we do have Katherine Hartner herself at Elmwood Park. How are you doing tonight, Katherine?
I'm doing great. It's been a really exciting night so far.
Now, I got some questions for you here first. Now, Katherine, what are the other effects does infrasound reportedly have on people?
Reportedly, it's had effects like people feeling nauseated, watched, a little bit off, and even some people have even reported mental health issues, but they haven't really positively tied that to infrasound.
Now, could infrasound be possibly used as a weapon? Is that true?
As far as we know, it's not true. I would not be surprised to find out that maybe back when they were the CIA was in the middle of Project MKUltra, I believe they tried to create an infrasound weapon, but they weren't able to really get it to work. And honestly, sonic weapons today are more focused on loud blasts of concentrated sound, not low-frequency sound.
Was there any other natural phenomena that had a bearing on the supernatural?
Well, when I talked to Luby Buckingham, he mentioned that residual hauntings, quartz and water can act almost like tape recorders, which I did not know, and I found that really cool, actually. But apart from that, really just storms was one thing that Lucy mentioned. Like all the electricity in the air can help ghosts manifest.
And last but not least, where do you personally stand on the supernatural?
I would call myself a skeptic. I would, like Dr. Wilson, I would like to be proved wrong, but until I have seen actual proof and can verify that that isn't just my own bias talking, I'm going to kind of stay a skeptic, but keep an open mind.
Now, it was to my understanding before you came live for this interview, something odd happened at Elmwood Park. Can you explain that to us real quick?
Well, we heard what we thought was almost a whale, like someone crying back in the trees. I thought it was a police siren, but the people I'm out here with said no, it sounded a little bit more like someone crying.
Halloween at its finest, creepy at its finest. I love it. Thank you, Katherine, for calling in from Elmwood Park. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Now we're going to go to a quick break before our next story. That was Katherine. Thank you very much. You're listening to Haunted Heartland on MavRadio.fm.
You just go through with that recording day tonight just as good as you possibly can.
Fear has no name. Fear has no address. Until now. CPEX 104. This is the 6th annual Haunted Heartland.
You're listening to MavRadio.fm, Omaha's college radio station.
Power with Mav Radio.
Omaha's number one college music station.
You're listening to Haunted Heartland on MavRadio.fm. Up next, we've got a short story by our very own Nicole Torin. This short story is titled The Westchester Woods. Now, it's a very interesting and unique take on Rob Cantor's Shia LaBeouf. So sit back and enjoy. Remember, you're listening to Mav Radio's 6th Annual Haunted Heartland.
This is a retelling of Rob Cantor's Shia LaBeouf Live. I knew I shouldn't have gone into the woods. Ever since the town's sweetheart Megan Williams went into the Westchester woods for a party one night 3 years ago and was never seen again, my mother warned me to stay away from those woods. It wasn't until the woods claimed its 12th victim with the disappearance of Reverend Carl McHale around 5 months ago did my mother create the rules. Rule number one, do not go into the Westchester woods. So much for that rule, I thought, as I walked amongst the so-called forbidden dark green pines. It's not like I went out of my way to defy her rule. I was a good kid, you see. Solid A student, vice president of my school's jiu-jitsu club, worked at the town library, volunteered at the local animal shelter. I didn't go out and party with all the other teens in town or get into crazy, borderline criminal shenanigans. I kept my head down, did my work. I was a good kid. And maybe that was the problem. I don't know if it was because the pressure of balancing all these extracurriculars in order to look good on a college application was finally getting to me, or maybe I was just fed up with being pushed into a locker for the 5th time that day by big shot Ted Toomley. But I just snapped. After the final bell, I got into my car, but instead of heading to Paws and Pals Rescue Shelter like I usually did on Tuesdays, I kept driving. Hell, I could barely remember the drive. My mind was fuming like a dormant volcano rumbling awake. I just drove and drove and drove until the road ended in front of the Westchester Woods. Now, I could have just turned around and kept driving, or maybe I could have just sat in my car and digest all the thoughts and worry buzzing in my head. No, I turned off the ignition, got out, and started walking. Walking in the Westchester Woods. So much for rule number one. And rule number two, do not go into the Westchester Woods alone. So, there I was, in the woods, alone. Stomping across the rocky dirt and fallen pine needles like a buffalo on a rampage. No real destination in mind, but just the crushing, blood-pounding need to trample everything in my path. It wasn't until I reached Lover's Cliff did I finally stop and realize how far I had walked. With winter fast approaching, the sun began to set earlier and earlier in the day. I peered out across the vast Northern California wilderness. The sun was just barely touching the top of Redwood Peak, and in only a few mere moments it would disappear behind it, plunging the woods into deep shadows. Which brings me to rule number three. Do not go into the Westchester Woods alone at night. I pulled out my phone to see that it was 5:06 p.m. and my phone's battery was down to 4%. Well, if I hustled back quickly the way I came, I would hopefully not break at least one of my mother's rules. I shoved my phone back into my jacket's pocket and took a single step. A chill settled in my chest as I slowly lifted my foot. There on the ground lay the splintered remains of a leg bone. It was slightly worn away with bits of dried blood and flesh still attached to it. It looked human.
Do it!
I looked my head around, but there was no one else. Only me. Must be the wind, I thought, shaking my head as I quickly began to follow the path back to my car. Just the wind. It had only been a few minutes when I heard it again.
Just do it!
No, that wasn't the wind. I kept walking, but out of the corner of my eye, I spotted him. Shia LaBeouf. He was barely recognizable from the person I watched when growing up. He had a thick, coarse beard like a lumberjack, and his curly dark hair was grown out and done into a braid. He looked more beast than man, wearing nothing but odd pieces of jewelry and a loincloth, showing off his pale, malnourished body. What in the hell was Hollywood superstar Shia LaBeouf doing in the Westchester Woods? Hello? I stopped and called to him. Are you okay? Do you need help? Ice pricked my heart as Shia LaBeouf said nothing but incoherent mutterings, like a madman in solitary confinement. Something wasn't right. Something terribly not right. Okay, well, I got to be going, so I'll just, bye. And I quickly resumed my walk to my car. Footsteps at a similar shuffling pace immediately followed behind me. I glanced over my shoulder. He was following me, about 30 feet back. I wanted to ask why, but something told me the reasoning would be in vain, so the words died in my throat as I picked up my pace. Shia LaBeouf stopped, and I thought that was the end of this odd game we seemed to be playing, but when I looked back once more, he got down on all fours like the beast he seemed to be. Then, he broke off into a sprint, rushing forward directly towards me. Terror crackled through me like a jolt of lightning bolt as I quickly turned around and sped off away from Shia LaBeouf as fast as my feet would take me. I could barely see where I was going as I stumbled and crashed through the brush in the dying light, but I couldn't stop. He was gaining on me. My legs and chest burned as I continued to run. I had to be getting close to my car soon, but my car and my escape were nowhere in sight. I glanced back and saw Shia LaBeouf was nearly upon me now. There was a crazed look in his eyes and dried blood smeared all over his face. My God, there was blood everywhere. I couldn't scream. I couldn't even breathe, really. Shia LaBeouf was going to kill me. Wow, I never thought I'd be saying something like that. I squeezed my eyes shut, ready for any second now when Shia LaBeouf would finally bring me down, when my foot stumbled against a twisted tree root. My eyes flashed open as my body pitched forward. Instead of just falling smack flat on my face, my body began to tumble down the cliffside. The world reeled around me like a carousel as rocks and plants cut at my skin and clothes. In what seemed like an eternity, but only a few seconds, did I finally crash onto flat ground and roll to a halt. It takes a few seconds for everything to stop spinning, and I slowly test my limbs. Nothing was broken. I stood and quickly took in my bearings. It was dark now, and I seemed to have lost Shia LaBeouf. The only problem was I was now hopelessly lost myself. The cliff I had fallen down from was too steep for me to possibly go back the way I came. I was stranded in the Westchester woods. God, I could hear my mother's, "I told you so," already. Well, hey, Mom, at least I wasn't alone. My heart rattled in my chest, expecting to come face to face with crazy eyes and bloody teeth. But it was only an owl. Okay, well, there was no point in me staying here, so I headed off in the clearest path, hoping I would come across some form of salvation, making my movements as quiet as possible. I'd only been walking for about 10 minutes when I spotted it. Aha! In the distance was a small cottage with a light on. Hope! Maybe they'd have a phone or at least an outlet for me to charge my phone so I could call my mother or the police. Warm tears pricked at the corner of my eyes as I stealthily moved towards my rescue. I was going to make it. I was going to be okay. Excruciating pain like the fires of hell surged through my right leg, quickly followed by a burning numbness. Nausea swept through me and the blood drained from my face as I looked down. The great menacing jaws of a bear trap were snapped shut around what used to be my calf. My inability to move my foot whatsoever, even failed attempts to just wiggle my toes, told me all I needed to know about the damage done. Oh God, I muttered, collapsing back down onto the cold, hard forest floor. With shaky hands, I tried to pull the bear trap's jaws apart, but to no avail. A stick, I thought, or something to wedge between the teeth and use as leverage to pry it open. I patted the area beside me and soon found what I thought was a stick. I picked it up and, oh my God, it was an arm. A human arm, with a shriveled hand still attached and clean in other parts down to the bone. There were teeth marks gnawed all over it. Human teeth marks. I quickly dropped the arm as if it were a live snake about to bite me. It was then that I spotted the rest of the poor fellow. They were more or less completely decomposed at this point, with no foul odor in the air. A few pieces of clothes were still attached to the skeletal body, including a golden cross necklace hanging around its neck. Reverend Carl McHale. Oh, God. So that was what happened to him, and Megan Williams, and so many others. They had been killed, like animals for sport, then feasted upon. Oh, God. A fire burned in my chest. No, this wasn't going to happen to me. I dug in the pockets of my jacket and found the Swiss Army knife my mother had gotten me for my 13th birthday when I used to be in the Scouts. I hardly used it anymore, but I had gotten into the habit of keeping it on me just in case. Lucky for me. If I was going to make it, I had to get out of this trap. Pulling out the biggest knife on the set, I gritted my teeth and began to saw off my leg where it was caught on the trap. Hesitation made it slow work at first, but after a couple minutes of sawing back and forth, I began to speed up like a prisoner filing away at their bars to get to freedom. Compared to the pain of getting trapped in the damn thing, this was nothing. Still, the thought didn't stop the nausea, and I swallowed back the vomit creaking in my throat. Just think you're cutting chicken. Just think you're cutting chicken, I told myself. In a cruel way, I was thankful the trap had broken my bones, and in a few minutes I was free. I cut off one of the sleeves of my jacket and tied it around the stump of my leg the best I could. I then removed my belt and made a tourniquet inches above my wound. It wouldn't stop the bleeding completely, but it would help for the time being. I set my eyes back on the cottage as I put my knife away and shuffled back onto my feet. Foot. I limped towards it, remaining as quiet as possible until I reached the doorstep. I went to grab the knob to the front door when I peered into the window, and my heart stopped. Sitting inside was Shia LaBeouf.
Oh, for really? I couldn't get one break, could I? Just one break.
I turned around, ready to hobble off before he realized I was there, when I stopped. No, I couldn't run, both literally and figuratively. I had to end this, end it all for good. I turned back towards the door and reached for the handle. Quieter than a mouse, I slowly turned the knob and the door opened. I cringed at every creak, but so far it didn't seem like Shia LaBeouf had heard me. He was too fixated on sharpening an axe and muttering his strange words. I pulled out one of the plastic bags I kept on me for walking the shelter dogs as I snuck up behind him. I didn't really have much of a plan, just the narrow-minded focus to live and survive. He was still concentrated on sharpening his axe as I took the bag and threw it over his head, strangling superstar Shia LaBeouf. He let out a guttural roar as he tossed his axe aside and tore away at the bag. I stumbled back, digging out my Swiss Army knife and flicking out the large blade once more. But Shia LaBeouf was quickly upon me, trying to wrestle it from my hands. His dirty, blood-soaked fingernails dug into my skin, but I held firm. He knocked me against a wall, and I briefly saw stars, so I returned the favor and sent my knee crashing between his legs. Shia LaBeouf howled and stumbled backwards, and I took the opportunity to stab my knife into where his kidneys would be. He let out a cry like a wounded beast as he fell to the floor and remained still. I did it. I was safe at last from Shia LaBeouf. I took the moment to catch my breath before I hopped over to the landline and called 911. After a few minutes of exchange, recounting my story, and with the dispatcher promising to send help, I hung up. I limped out onto the porch, blood oozing still from my stump leg. Despite the nightmare that had happened this evening, it was actually a pretty beautiful night. I grinned, taking in a deep breath, the cool, sharp smell of pines. I had survived the Westchester woods. I had beaten Shia LaBeouf. My blood ran cold as if liquid nitrogen was being pumped through my veins. I slowly turned around, and there, with a gun to my head and death in his eyes, was Shia LaBeouf.
Wait, he isn't dead! Shia, surprise!
Are you freaking kidding me? Oh my, that was it! I had had it with this motherfucking Shia LaBeouf in these motherfucking woods.
My eyes were seeing red as I knocked the gun aside and body slammed superstar Shia LaBeouf. I sat up and kicked the gun into the dark underbrush as Shia LaBeouf reached for it once more. Fury flared in his eyes as he went to grab for me instead, but it quickly rolled to the side and shakily stood. He then tried to charge at me like a raging bull, but I was able to deflect that as well. Shia LaBeouf continued to try to take me out, but each attempt was met with a swift aversion. Thank goodness Mom made me keep doing jujitsu. I stumbled upon the axe Shia LaBeouf had tossed aside before and hastily picked it up. My tourniquet had gotten loose, and blood was draining fast from my stump leg. I needed to end this. As Shia LaBeouf got closer, I heaved the great weapon and took a swung, but this time he was the one to easily dodge. I kept trying to hit him, but he dodged every swipe. He then parried to the left, but I countered to the right, catching him in the neck. Shia LaBeouf collapsed onto his knees as blood spurted from his neck like a geyser. His gnarled hands clawed at his wound as if that could somehow halt the blood flow, but his eyes shined with the fear he knew his end was upon him. I grinned as I stood over him, heaving the axe over my shoulder like a baseball batter. Oh, and I hated Transformers too, I sneered, then swung. His body slumped down as his head toppled to the floor, expressionless. Have a nice time in hell, I spat, as I fell to my knees, catching my breath. I was finally safe from Shia LaBeouf.
We hope that you've enjoyed that short story by Nicole Torin, her very own take on Shia LaBeouf from Rob Cantor. Up next, we've got another throwback from John Borgmeyer with the Squirrel Cage Jail. Remember that you're listening to MAV Radio's 6th Annual Haunted Heartland.
Before I started here, yeah, I've seen some weird things on and off, kind of, you know, is it my imagination, is it this? But working in this building all the time, there's a lot more out there that we don't know about.
In the heart of downtown Council Bluffs stands a historic and eerie structure, a relic of the past that housed violent criminals captured in the Midwest for nearly a century. A jail that's design was revolutionary for its time, yet faced failures from the get-go. Museum coordinator Carla Begalia says that sometimes prisoners would do anything to get out of their cells.
This is the infirmary, so when the guys got tired of being in their cells, they would get it spinning around pretty good, stick an arm or a leg through the bars. Yes, but you gotta come up here and this room doesn't spin in circles.
It's I don't think view. It's worth it.
Well, it wasn't worth it when Otto Gudath was the jailer. Do you know why?
Because he just...
butcher.
Oh, cut it right off.
Designed as a county jail, this three-story rotating prison has housed countless prisoners on Pearl Street in downtown Council Bluffs, the Squirrel County Jail, better known as the Squirrel Cage Jail. Built in 1885, it was one of 18 rotary jails constructed in the Midwest, and the only one of its kind that was three stories tall. According to Miss Bergalia, the cells rotated day and night. Some believe that spirits of old prisoners, a guard, and some house cats still haunt the building, possibly due to being driven mad by the spinning or from the few that have died within this confines walls. Many paranormal groups have conducted experiments and research at the jail. Miss Borgelia says that while working at the jail, she has seen paranormal activity firsthand.
I've had the pleasure of having my hat pulled off my head and my hair played with. I've been poked. I've heard voices.
Miss Borgelia is not the only person, or a group of people for that matter, that have been touched by spirits while at the jail. She says that paranormal research groups have investigated the building many times.
The groups that come through are just incredible, whether they're just a small, semi-professional group or whether they're, you know, Nevermore Paranormal, UN Paranormal, you know, places that have been established for a while.
Paranormal Distraction, LLC, an Omaha and Kansas City-based paranormal research group, has experienced phenomena in the building as well. Founded by Aaron Wheeler and Angelique Christensen, the group uses equipment designed for paranormal research. Angelique has studied paranormal activity since first becoming interested as a child.
Scariest was, and I wouldn't really say scary, more startled for me because I've done this for a long time. Would be up on the fourth floor, the man that doesn't like us being up there, and he constantly follows me around, and he is right here at my back, and he's always in my ear, and he's right there. He won't even stand here. He's got to be right up against me. And so I'm like, just give me my space, you know, and stop.
Saturday night, Paranormal Distraction hosted an event at the Squirrel Cage Jail. The purpose? To teach amateur ghost hunters how to apply paranormal research equipment to detect and record the spirits of the dead. During the event, they taught their students to use several types of equipment, such as wiki sticks, spirit boxes, and electronic voice phenomenon recorders, better known as EVPs. The group also acts as a guide and helps guests keep an eye open for ghosts. While on the tour, guest Michael Bolden was approached by Paranormal Distraction member and psychic medium Renee Ingram with a message from his grandmother.
You have something that keeps breaking down? She tells me that that's her. She's here with you. She wants me to let you know that. And she's a kick in the old butt, by the way. And so she won't leave me alone until I came up here and told you this. You need a new truck or something. So.
I was just talking about it.
Yeah. She says don't go too much on it, though. Don't go crazy. Keep it down low. Get what you can afford. You know, we all do that. So.
Yeah, I know. That's
God
kinda,
bless you. She's coming from the light. She's up there. She's very much so crossed over. Do you have anything else you want to say to him? I want to ask. She loves you.
I love her too.
You just told her. Okay. Have
Thank
fun.
You.
Enjoy.
So, that is so
weird.
Michael was brought to the event by a friend and was surprised that he had become a part of the experience. As the night went on, the guests had free rein of the building and went around using equipment to find spirits and generally have a good time. For Mav Radio, I'm John Borgmeyer.
And that was one of the many stories we have pulled from the archive. Remember, we will have one more closing out this Haunted Heartland. But before we do so, we're going to go to Aaron Butler's story. When you think of the University of Nebraska at Omaha, murder isn't the first thing that comes to your mind, or is it? Reporter Aaron Butler tells a tale to chill you to your very core.
"62 years, 10 months, and 4 weeks. Is it possible for someone to stay in one place for that long? December 10th, 1955. 20-year-old junior Carolyn Marie Nevins just finished working in the University of Omaha library at 10 p.m. While walking to the bus stop, had her life stolen from her.
She was taken in a car by somebody and then killed and then just dropped off in the front of Kaiser.
4 bullets. One in the left arm, 2 in her right arm, and the last proved to be fatal, was to the neck.
The buses or shuttles stopped running by the time she was done, so she was just waiting outside for her dad to come pick her up.
Many hours later, at 4 a.m., her father, Arthur J. Nevins, concerned, informed the police that his daughter had failed to meet him when he went to the university to drive her home.
They didn't find her body till maybe the next morning.
When her body was found in a university parking lot just 200 feet away from what was then the highway, she was clinging on to 2 dimes, indicating that she was indeed headed to catch the bus and not to get a ride home with her father.
And I think there's a whole miscommunication about, like, did her brother or did her dad pick her up?
An apparent miscommunication that turned deadly. Detective Inspector Ernest Brown said there was no evidence of robbery or rape. About 500 feet from where her body was found, police located the co-ed's shoes. She must have crawled 150 feet down the driveway to seek help. The gun used, believed to have been a .32 caliber revolver, Carolyn's executioner, was never found.
There are groups around campus dedicated to finding paranormal mysteries and attempting to solve them. The University of Nebraska at Omaha's Paranormal Society is one of them. This society, alongside the Omaha Police, has yet to make any significant development in the case. Mav Radio thanks Aaron Thomas for the chilling story surrounding this case. Now we're going to go on to our very final story of this Haunted Heartland. It's going to be Isaac Graff and the History of Halloween. How did Halloween come to be? What made us start going house to house asking for candy from neighbors? As reporter Isaac Graff explains, this holiday has a history that spans centuries, cultures, religions, and borders. An interesting past that makes this possibly one of the most complicated of any current holiday.
Trick or treat.
This is what most think of around this time of year. Kids in costumes going house to house, trick-or-treating, trying to collect the most amount of candy they can, and as UNO student Hannah Burr explains, movies are just as big a part of Halloween as they are any other holiday, as she lays out what her priorities were as a kid when it was almost Halloween.
What I was gonna wear, how many Reese's Pieces I could eat, and how many times I could watch Hocus Pocus.
Others may look forward to decorating their houses with jack-o'-lanterns, ghosts, and spiderwebs, even making the costumes themselves.
Since my name's Hannah, I was Hannah Montana one year, and we're both blonde, and we're both really good at singing, so I think I fit the part pretty well. I wore a dress, and I straightened my hair, and I put on lots of makeup that did not look good because I was probably 10, and had no clue how to put on makeup.
And as many age, they look forward to wandering through cornfields and houses, trying not to act scared, even when they are. But as Halloween has become more and more commercialized, many do not know the origins of Halloween and how it came to be this candy hunt of a holiday. There are many stories about the background of Halloween and how it all started, but according to UNO archivist Les Valentine, one story is the most believed.
General consensus is that it's a Christian event to honor people who have passed on, whether they be saints or whether they be just ordinary people. And various cultures have ways to honor the people who have passed on. And And if you look up Halloween in the wiki or in somewhere else, there's all kinds of ways to celebrate this.
But where did this idea of dressing up in costumes come from, you may ask? Well, this is just the Western world's way to celebrate this holiday.
In the Western world, meaning, you know, like England and America, it's dressing up. Whether you're an adult, you go to a party and you dress up, or whether you're a kid and you dress up and you go to people's house and ask for trick-or-treat.
Also, it may be a disguise.
In the old days, you wanted to kind of disguise yourself from the dead. Yeah. You didn't want to know, if you're messing around with the dead, you didn't want them to know who you were. So you had a costume on. And you know, that just evolved now. And I think it's at least as much fun for kids to get dressed up as it is to get the candy.
And think about the house decorations, such as spiderwebs, ghosts, and jack-o'-lanterns, as the same disguise, but for your house. So as we all have fun scaring ourselves, eating way too much candy, and having some of the strangest parties of the year, let's not forget the ones who came before us and created this very spooky holiday. For MavRadio.fm, I'm Isaac Graff.
For such an interesting past, it's funny how most do not know what we are celebrating on this very spooky holiday. Though most enjoy the holiday not only for the history, but for the scares. And we have reporter Isaac Graff with us now live to dive in a little deeper. Now, Isaac, you talked about the Western world. Your story can tell us anything about the Eastern world celebrates Halloween.
Yeah, for the Eastern world, they don't have a ton of history with they still honor their dead or their passings, but they don't necessarily have a specific holiday like especially in the Middle East or in Asia. There wasn't a ton of background that I could find on them on a specific day like Halloween, how we do here in the Western world of honoring the saints, and it's just the family members that have passed on in the past year. So,
now, were there any facts that you found out but weren't able to report on, but now is your chance? Were there any other facts that you have for us?
Yeah, one thing that I didn't get to add into the piece was that they Halloween especially had a Roman Catholic aspect beginning to it, like I said in the piece, but a lot of it was actually Irish too. That's where you see a lot of like the history of like jack-o'-lanterns and stuff like that. That's where that jack-o'-lanterns especially, that's what one thing a lot of people I think would be interested to know is that's where jack-o'-lanterns actually started, was in the Irish and the Celtic times.
Now, going into this story, you personally, what was your background of Halloween and what did you find out from this story?
There was a lot of stuff that I didn't know about Halloween. I pretty much knew the background that everybody else does. Dress up in a costume and go house to house and ask for candy and then make a jack-o'-lantern. That was what that was my background on it. But before during the story, I did learn a lot about about the Celt, like I said, the Celtic past, and then diving in deeper of like honoring the dead and where it all started with the Roman Catholics and stuff like that.
Now, before we let you go, any additional thoughts or comments you would like to add?
No, not specifically about the piece, but I just want to say I hope everybody enjoyed our Haunted Heartland 2018 and have a fun rest of your night.
All right, thank you very much, Isaac. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Now that story actually concludes our Haunted Heartland. The 3 hours are up. Now, Anna, any last words?
We appreciate you guys tuning in this year, Mav Radio's 6th annual Haunted Heartland. We just want to thank all the reporters out in the field. Hopefully you've got to your destination safely and are making your way back home. Big thanks to Harrison, my co-host for tonight.
And a thank you to you too. It's mutual.
A huge thanks to Ben Phillips here in the studio producing for us.
No problem.
A huge thanks to Mav Radio, as always, a great team to work with. And another huge thanks to Lyle for creating all the graphics that you see tonight. Make sure that you like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, Instagram. Remember hashtag PowerWith whenever you do. You've been listening to Mav Radio's 6th annual Haunted Heartland.
We hope you've enjoyed this year's annual Haunted Heartland. You barely made it out alive. But we can't guarantee your safety next time. Join MAV Radio again next year for another round of bone-chilling tales.